tongue and anus, needless to say, brainless. So take a deep breath and think gracious before I scar all your faces, leaving that flavor ass tasteless. Still you boast about cheese lost in the rap races, fabricating first places, champ, you can't even tie them shoelaces. Rookie, get back to basics, take 10 nostalgic paces, bow your head and get wasted as the mere echo of my phrases replaces what used to be your mental mazes. Then again, the preceding statement raises much room for debate, since your labyrinth was a cubicle with an open door. In terms of this metaphor, of course, you poor falling meteor, of course, intended to plummet ever more throughout the cosmos, except your path brought you dangerously close to the burning mass.
That is some fucking deep shit.
Okay. Ladies and gentlemen, now the moment you've all been waiting for.
Some fire shit.
Fire.
A man that can spit his way out of a fucking a dilemma.
There it is.
A really complicated dilemma.
Ladies and gentlemen, now the moment you've all been waiting for.
You are now listening to the sounds of the Milkcrates Microphones.
What does it do?
Yo,
what's it for?
Well, nothing. I mean, nothing.
Don't stay too fucking low, man. We got a lot of work to do, bro.
Don't worry. Catch you on the flip side.
You love the spaceship with the rocket fuel.
We choose to go to the moon in this decade and do the other thing.
You really think you can fly that thing?
You really think you can do all that bullshit you just said?
3, 2, 1.
Here we go again, another podcast, another night, and another shot that Sid walks right through. We are Milk Crates and motherfucking Microphones. I am B-Sick, what a ride, Mr. Brandon F. on Fry. And boy, do we have a special one for you tonight. We are here live, and we have a great guest coming on in about 15 to 20 minutes. But before we do any of that, let me introduce the man in front of me. You know who he is. It's your boy, his boy, their boy, everybody's boy, soldier's boy, plus the Suicide Boys, and the Hype Boys, and the Beastie Boys, and the Beach Boys.
That's a lot of boys.
There's a lot of boys there. I'm fans of the boys. So once again, it's your boy, the Infamous Nonsense, and I'm glad to fucking be here on a Friday night. You know what I mean? It's just good to be around the homies and just fucking kicking some good shit, some good memories, some good thoughts, some good conversations, and got those for you. So I appreciate you tuning in. Stick with us for a good show, baby.
We are going to be, like I said, getting into a very special interview with a very special guest here very shortly, and a bunch of stuff in before that and after that, so stick with us. If you're watching this on YouTube, please go download us on all your podcast apps. If you are listening to this on a podcast, please go listen or watch on YouTube, subscribe, do all that fun shit. But now that that's all out of the way, let me introduce the man to the left of me. He'll be in that seat from now to infinity. You used to know him in JS3. Now he is
triple motherfucking 666.
He hits a home run over the fence and it's gone.
Yo, what is good? Hey, I'm fucking pumped up. It's Friday the 13th. It's a weird day already, and I have one of my favorite weird artists coming on tonight.
I didn't even realize that it was Friday the 13th.
Yes,
way to bury the lead, right? It is Friday the 13th, and here we are just doing another podcast. This is 15 of the 7th season, so we're somewhere in that like 165 range, I want to say.
Some people say today's a good day. Some people say today's a bad day.
I think it's going to be a great day.
It's going to be a great day.
Hey, judging by the level of guests that we have, I think it's going to be a very, very good.
Well, I did fuck around. I hit a triple-double earlier, so, hey, it's going to be a good day. There you go.
Well, we'll have to learn more about that triple-double here in a little bit, but before we do any of that, before we get to our guests and get into any of that other shit, we got to do something we always do, and that's a little something that we like to call This Week in Motherfucking Hip-Hop.
Speaking of motherfucking triple
one
doubles.
One for one this year.
There you go. Speaking of motherfucking triple doubles, your boy O'Shea Jackson Sr.
Oh, shit.
Born.
Oh, Fetty?
Born. No. Your boy Ice Cube.
Oh, okay.
Was born
Did
June
you think it was 15th.
That's exactly why I said that.
Wait a second. What's 50's name?
Today's going to be. That's Curtis Jackson.
Curtis Jackson.
Oh, come
that's
on,
where
man.
I got the
come
Jackson.
On,
they're Jackson.
O'Shea's. O'Shea's this guy.
Okay, O'Shea.
Born June 15th, 1969. Better known as his stage name, Ice Cube, was in a movie that could no longer be unforgiven, if not forgotten, if not played on every other stoner holiday, if not played just for the fuck of it.
next Friday, Friday, and Friday after next. But this movie in particular, I'm
Why'd
talking
you
about
order.
Yeah, that was a weird order, but
it doesn't matter.
We did the next Friday before the Friday.
Friday, next Friday, Friday after next.
It's all good. It's all good.
Speak it any way you can. This movie just dropped January 12, 2000, making this movie 23 fucking years old.
Next Friday did?
Yes.
Friday. Okay. Oh,
23
wow.
years
I
old.
I remember when it dropped. I remember it going.
97 was the first one, right?
No, yeah.
I want to say 97 was the first one, yeah. So it's pretty crazy to think that this movie is that fucking old. 23 years old.
So I remember I think I was in eighth or freshman. It might have been eighth grade. And I remember it coming out and talking with everyone like, yeah, we need to go see this movie. And
good movie.
I remember us talking about like, what if they made another one? What would it be called? And I came up with the Friday After Next, which they eventually came. I mean,
crazy.
I didn't come up with it, but
crazy.
I brought that. To
that
like,
would have been your,
like,
that would have been
be
your number
name.
Two. Your number two would be Friday After Next. Huh? We go what? Friday, then Friday After
no,
Next.
No. We were talking about like we were going to go see this movie back then, and I remember having a conversation with my friends.
If there was a trek.
If there's going to be a third one,
God,
what are they going to name
it?
Because we were just making jokes.
What
is
they called
I mean?
It? A triplet or trickle?
And they actually named it Friday After Next.
What they call the sequel?
No.
I don't know if there's a name.
It's a trequel, isn't it?
Is that a trequel?
What is it?
I mean, it could be.
No. Could it be a trequel?
We just maybe we invented a fucking word.
Oh, my God.
Trequel.
No.
It's
they call it the third installment is what they normally call it. But
trifecta.
It? Trifecta. I mean,
it's a franchise.
It's a trinity.
It's a movie franchise.
It's a trinity.
Yeah. I don't know what they call that, but the third
but, hey,
one, the third installment.
Okay, so let's move on. Sorry. Next Friday.
So this is Next Friday. It's it's a stoner comedy film sequel, 1995. Set was the first one, actually, for Friday. It was 95. Which is a classic cult classic here. If you ain't fucking with Next Friday, I mean, you might be sleeping. You got Mike Epps. You got his fucking dad that's done passed away. What was his name again? What was his
he's
name?
He's a good dude.
It's not Tommy. Tommy Lester was a Debo.
Was Debo. Who's also rest in peace.
Rest in peace. And homies, rest in peace. And all I know is that this movie is classic
John
hilarious.
Witherspoon.
John Witherspoon. Witherspoon. Thank
classic
you.
Classic hilarious. You got Tamela Jones, John Witherspoon, Mike Epps. I mean, you can't go wrong here. It's a classic.
Next
I mean,
Friday. Okay, so tell good. Me if you didn't think that fucking Uncle Leroy's lady was hot.
Oh, yeah. I would have given her the
something
counter.
About it.
I would have given her the
something
counter.
About her, dude. What?
That's old girl from...
I don't know. I don't care about
she's
anything else.
What's she for? Sister,
she's
sister?
In a lot
sister,
of
sister, sister, sister.
Oh, you're right.
The mom from Sister, Sister.
It is.
Yeah, yeah.
It is.
Yeah, they were she was the mom.
Oh,
and
where he says the old raggedy titties when she says talking about the raggedy... What movie is that where
she
talks about raggedy titties, remember?
I don't know.
She didn't say that on Sister, Sister, though. God damn it.
It's a family show.
Not on Tia and Tamara's time.
What movie was that where she was in that one shirt and she goes, you don't like my body? You don't like my titties? And she's in that one movie with the, I think it was a cop movie.
But
maybe?
I remember feeling I probably shouldn't think that she's that hot because she's kind of older and thicker. And
she's the Next Friday?
Auntie Sugar.
Auntie Sugar.
No, that's not fucking what's her name
that's
from fucking
her?
Next Friday. Hell no. That's a different.
is that not her?
That's not her.
She's not in Sister, Sister Sister?
That's okay. Fucking Tamela Jones you talking
Whitley.
About.
Okay.
You talking about Tamela Jones.
Okay.
Sister, Sister.
Yeah, maybe she wasn't in Sister, Sister.
Nah. Sister, Sister.
Hold on. No,
she wasn't.
It's not. That. It's that one chick.
What was she in? What
anyways.
Movie? Okay.
Moving on.
Anyways, yeah, she.
We're going to play a song.
Hold on. Yeah,
she wasn't Sister. Is that not
No. Let me see.
No,
that's not the girl from Sister, Sister.
No, that's
not.
Okay.
That girl got the titties.
Well, my bad.
Well, anyways, this is a great movie if you're a fucking true stoner. Pinky's my favorite and shit.
Yeah.
And when he pulls up in the Cadillac and he says, you better slow the motherfucking down on them turns. You made me spill my yak on my fucking $25 suit. My favorite stuff, you know. So off the album itself, I want to play Fried Day
Hell
by
yeah.
Busy Bone.
Fuck yeah, that's
right.
A good track.
Classic bro. Track. So let's go ahead and get into that right now. This is your boy from the Next Friday soundtrack, Busy Bone with Friday.
I want a bag.
Bag of Dakota, bag of Dakota, run.
I want a bag.
You gotta get the vacuum out, though. Suck up the smoke. Suck up John's lip.
What was the white boy's name?
Roach.
Roach. No, that's a dog.
It was Roach.
If I had my bong, I'd let you smoke till you choke.
Don't get you fucked up. I'm gonna get you fucked up.
Chico.
Dog with Chico.
Chico.
Yep. He has Chico in the new one, or in the Friday After Next, the Christmas one.
Yeah. Chico's getting stoned still.
Endo and chronic, hydrolyzed dick and I can't think of some more. Yeah, time to smoke spit. So I know how they come around on Friday, bro. For deep, boy, yes, and we pray.
Hey, did that camera get called in? Yeah, all right, cool. I wasn't sure if I was going to hit the button.
I didn't. Cool. Every first Friday of the month. And y'all humbly invited. We're truly humbly indicted. Enemies and all of y'all hate on when I get my fate on. I'm so high.
So who wanna bag? Who wanna bag? You wanna bag? You wanna bag? You gotta bag souls. And about that dog to the nigga stone.
You wanna bag? Bag the quarter.
That's Busy Bone with Friday.
Fire, fire, fire.
Very good. That brings you back. And it's a classic 4 minute and 30 second track.
You know they're supposed to make a part four, right? They've been forever. They
They've been talking about
they
it.
They got the cue on it now.
Well, no, they have rejected these scripts so much now that Ice Cube just recently came out and said, I'm going to fucking take over this project. And just let me fucking make
it's
this
because
decision.
Studios,
I thought they got the okay, though.
Studios recently. Don't want to do no. any, like, graphic comedy because they're afraid that it's going to offend people and they're not going to make money
I can
on
see that.
It, right?
I can see that.
What do you mean graphic comedy? What's that mean?
Well, for
like,
raunchy
comedy. Like
very
raunchy. Yeah.
Yeah,
like raunchy style comedy.
Times have changed, man.
Yeah, and people get offended. You're going to see stuff like that, though, pop up on these streaming services because Netflix will pay for it. If you can't get Paramount to play for it, Netflix will put it on. Netflix. Oh, I got. Guess what happened? Workaholics. Okay. First of all, let's. Stamp
oh, let's
that.
Wrap this up real quick.
Stamp that.
Before
Busy
we go.
Bone.
Before we go, we got a Milkhead in here. James Morales saying, "Rest in peace, Roach." I forgot he passed away.
Oh fuck.
I forgot. Right, away, yeah, Roach. I forgot he passed all away. Right. He killed himself. I remember that. He did. Whoa. Sorry, he suicided himself. Excuse me. Ooh, I don't know. Is it proper? I don't know. I'm just trying
know.
To say. I'm
I
just trying
either,
to say.
Hey, R.I.P.
Give the guy respect.
Moment
give
of
R.I.P.
Justin Pierce.
Moment of silence. Justin Pierce.
Tease and peace to that man. All respects, no disrespect.
Jesus, moment of silence.
Where were you?
You son of a bitch.
Jesus, this room is so toxic.
Hey, I'll tell you this. I think the only way to fucking commemorate and celebrate Roach is to smoke that motherfucking
roach. You gotta smoke a
roach.
You gotta smoke a roach is what you gotta do. There you go.
Hey, but what were you saying before that?
Where were you?
Workaholics?
Where were you, Workaholics?
So Workaholics was gonna be putting out a movie. They've been writing it for, Durs came up with a screenplay.
Yeah.
They've been writing it for, because I listened to their podcast. They've been talking about it.
This is important.
He finally got it all written. They're getting... building sets, getting ready to start shooting next week.
All original, all three of them?
Yeah, yeah.
Okay, okay.
All four of them.
Okay, and
Carl.
And Carl, yeah.
Yeah,
okay.
Yeah.
That's Mr. Kyle. Rape Van, Mr. Rape
yeah,
Van himself.
So he was going to direct it and produce it because that's his gig. It got canceled. It got fucking pulled. The network pulled it, or Fox, or whoever the fuck was.
Really?
Paramount
pulled,
Plus. No, Paramount Plus.
Yeah, they pulled
Paramount Plus pulled the project.
It was a Paramount Plus
so
film.
So now they have to go and pitch it to other people. So they got to go to Netflix.
I thought it was going to Netflix. Because Game Over Man was Netflix. Why wouldn't this one be
a Paramount Plus is the one picked it up. They wanted to do it. They wanted, I guess they... So they were like, fuck it. Let's just tell the whole story.
Why'd they step
they
away?
Picked up the movie, and they wanted to do a spinoff. With, like, you know, new characters, a new TV show spinoff of Workaholics. Uh-huh. And they were, like, signing off on it, all that. They were like, yeah, let's do it, fucking. You paid for us to do this movie. And they were like, basically, we're doing the movie so all we can get, like, the gang back together, all the, like, the videographers and
Do they give
you,
you funding? So Paramount's giving you funding?
Yeah.
So now
they
funded you before and they pulled the money, like, now you owe me? Or, like, they just never got it?
They never got them. They never really got to film. They never broke ground. It wasn't started. You know, they spent time. They're not going to get paid for their time writing the movie, but they also have that. That's their original work, so they can go and sell that still. They still have the fucking script
ready
to go.
Hold on. So the movie's not filmed?
Not even close.
I thought it was coming out this year. Wasn't that what you were trying to say?
Might have been projected.
Wasn't that the thing that you said you were looking forward to this year was the Workaholics
movie? Son of a bitch.
that's what
I was working on.
So it was projected to be this year.
You act like they couldn't get it out by Christmas.
No, for sure they could.
Shit.
They could.
I mean,
that's a whole year of filming.
I don't know how fast it takes them to film some episodes of Workaholics.
3 to 4 months of filming.
I would say a solid
They could jam through some shit. They have a good... They all click, bro.
And not only that, their sets aren't that crazy. Like, they were going to do most of the filming in a warehouse and just build an office inside a warehouse.
Bitch better have my honey. Bitch better have my honey.
That's the best. Yeah, so that's something that kind of really kicked me in the nuts when I heard that this week.
Yeah.
Because I've been looking forward to it.
That's kind of sucks. You know, that's a damper.
I've been listening to their podcast, you know,
since you told me that they had a podcast. Yeah. And then I was like, dove
and
in.
And then you took over.
One of those things, you know me, I fucking. Off.
He does. He took fully. Gave Bob does sports. The man goes all the way to the beginning. So he runs. He's running far.
Well, not only that, you got to start. I go all the way back. Like, I listen to.
I can't do it. I can't.
Oh, this is great. So then I go all the way back.
It hurts me.
Because the current events they're talking about is off, though, too.
Yeah. And you've also seen what the projected good stuff is. And it's hard to
with Workaholics, the podcast, it's they're just fucking talking shit, and it's really they really don't talk about current events much. Yeah. Like they do every once in a while, they'll throw something in there, but most of it's just like, hey, what you been up to? Da da da. Just bullshitting and talking shit.
Have you watched the new Bob?
Yeah, they did the rematch.
As long as you're up to date on your Bob, good deals.
Something I did watch recently.
Perez was on fucking darts,
bro. Did you see them on the Golf Channel?
Who, Perez was on
all
the golf
of them, all three of them, Cutsy, fucking Bob, crazy. And Perez on the Golf Channel, and they were doing like commentary for the fucking the biggest what's it called that just happened?
They blew up, bro.
Dude, they're on the fucking thing doing commentary. So we have such and such going to the fucking to the green right now. How do you feel about this, Perez?
Good
well, the
him.
Man, the man's got a small swing on him. I don't know if he's gonna carry. Dude, it was
for people
great.
That don't know what we're talking great. About. A YouTube channel called Bob Does Sports,
blown up.
They do a lot of golfing stuff, and or that's all they do now. But very good channel. They're very entertaining.
Great.
I very mean, even if you don't like uplifting. Watching golf, this is a brand of golf I think everybody can enjoy because it's first person.
Targeted for everybody.
They're not – I mean, they're good. Like, cut fat – I mean, obviously, FP's fucking
– FP's the king.
He's really good.
He's king.
And then there's FP? Another dude, Joey Cole – Fat Perez is his name.
Oh, okay.
Joey Colcuts, he's decent. Joey like, he's Cole better cuts. Than everyone in this room right now. Yeah. And then Bob is good.
Bob's
like my
getting
good.
Really
Bob's,
good.
Yeah, Bob's. I don't know. What are you talking good. About, bro? He played like trash in this last week.
Yeah, he did. But before that one, he played
oh,
really
dude,
good.
Oh, dude, I've seen
really
him play. Good. He played with Grant like a couple months ago.
And he was and great. Grant Rochambeau?
Like, Grant was like, whoa, this motherfucker's getting good.
Grant Rochambeau, right? Rochambeau, whatever his name is.
Grant Horvath.
Oh, Horvath. Okay. Who am I thinking of? Rochambeau. What's his last name?
I don't know.
It's something like that. But yeah, I thought he was getting
good stuff, though. Good stuff.
Very good. Very good show.
What do you got over here?
Something I did see recently. Kai, the hatchet-wielding, what
hitchhiker.
Was it? Hitchhiker.
The one-kick master. The one-kick master.
So what do you think about this man? Like, and it's crazy because he was, for one,
so
from Fresno and then hanging out in Stockton.
Yeah, so you guys don't
highest
remember when this
fastest.
Went down?
I kind of don't, man.
See, highest, so, fastest, rise to fame.
So
and
I,
speedball down.
I remember when it all happened. I remember watching the video and watching it tons of times. Me and Brett were just talking about this. Why, like... The fucking lines that he was dropping, I remember thinking it wasn't real and being like, this is not a real interview, like, because he's, like, cussing and shit and he's with a fucking reporter. But it was because the reporter put the B-roll on YouTube, which we didn't really know at the time. We just thought it was, like, this is what you saw on fucking Fox or whatever. But wild thing, the whole story, the rise to fame.
Quick and over. Quick
and then
quick
straight
spark,
down.
Quick
I remember
spark.
Reading about the fact that he killed somebody else and thinking, this guy is a wild man.
They said he was date raped.
Yeah. We'll talk crazy. A little bit more about that in a
we'll
little bit.
We'll get back
bit.
Into that. Yes, sir.
We got...
That was a crazy documentary, though.
It was good. It was okay.
And it was pretty, like, close to home.
Well, because,
yeah,
it was... because
you're hatchet-wielding
in Fresno, which is just south of us, and then coming to Stockton, which is our neighbor, you know what I mean? Like,
yeah.
It was... But I remember thinking... I remember when it happened, watching the video and thinking that... Not thinking that... Thinking what everyone thought, you love this guy. He's a good dude. He fucking saved someone's life, and he seemed like a really sweethearted
dude.
Sure.
And another guy I love.
Yes. Joining us now, another person that we love. Can you hear us? How's the audio?
I don't know. We can't hear him.
Uh-oh.
Are you there?
Yo.
Yeah, okay,
there you
got
are.
Can you hear us?
Oh, man.
Uh-oh.
We can hear you.
We can hear you perfect. You.
Can you hear us?
I can hear you now. Can you guys hear me?
We can hear you great. You sound great.
Awesome.
Technical difficulties. What's up, fellas?
Let's go. What's up? So joining us now, he's a fucking legend in the art world, also in the music world, co-founder of Anticon, and somebody that we've looked up to for a long time. Give it up for the one and only Doseone.
Hell yeah.
Woo! Thank you, fellas. It's great to meet you all.
Hey, thank you so much for joining us, taking time out of your Friday. We really appreciate it.
Pleasure.
Been looking forward to this conversation all week and really, really excited about it. So let's dive in.
Dose,
let's do it.
Dose, where are you based out of these days?
I don't know. Depends. No, Santa Fe, New Mexico. I moved here to be a part of Meow Wolf, which was kind of a nightmare. But I bought a house, and I love my house. So I got my cats. I got a nice lady, a motherfucking hot tub, a studio. You know.
What more do you need?
Fuck it.
Yeah, living life.
Sounds wonderful to me. I know you're a cat guy. How many cats do you have, man?
11.
I wish. I have two cats. I think more than two is a lot. One of them's sick, but they're dumpster cats. I've been rescuing cats since I was like 8 years old.
That's a good thing.
That's
awesome.
That's always nice. Yeah. Sometimes you get more animals, and some of them are losing attention because they're so needy as it is. You know what I mean? So it's kind of unfair to them.
Yeah, they're enough. One of them has like is in renal failure, so she's like constantly needing meat and water. Oh, it's a whole thing. I love it.
Yeah, it's like kids.
That's why I'm not breeding, because I got this needy cat, you know?
No need to.
That's right.
Let's talk a little bit about the music journey that you've been on, because it has been quite a run. Talk about longevity. Somebody that's been making music since the 90s. You started out battle rapping. A lot of the stuff that I learned about you was from Scribble Jam shit.
Right.
Talk a little bit about that and the art of freestyling, because I know it's something really close to your heart that the art of actually freestyling off of the top, improv on the spot, something that you've held close to yourself.
That was like, so my arc starts. So I was Doseone when I was a tagger and like a little even shittier person, hoodlum. And so I think at like 15, I was tagging Dose, and then I started rapping at 16. And it was all freestyle. And sort of everybody freestyled. I missed this a little after that. It's not really that when I started, but a little after that, you could just walk down the street and it was like Mary Poppins of hip hop. There'd be like dudes ciphering and you could like hop in. Philly was pretty authentic. Hip hop was real thanks to the Roots. We used to sneak into the truck and see the Roots when I was a kid. And everybody in Philly, you'd be at a party and everyone would lie about being in Organics and being in the Roots. You meet some dude and he'd be like, yeah, I'm in the Roots. He'd be like, are you? And then so anyway, I was freestyling, and then I was in Jersey in a battle crew called Skill Scavengers. We would just serve everybody, and so it was like aggressive freestyling, just sort of eating people's faces. And then around that era, everybody started coming with these like amazing writtens, and every single cipher would go at lesser person would like devolve it into writtens, you know, and sound perfect. And so I only started writing raps so I could have something to compete with the like Chads that dropped writtens. And then a couple years after that, I got moved to Cincinnati. And I was like, my fucking rap career is over, yo. And then I met Jay Rawls. So when I got to Cincinnati, nobody really rapped. And so I would crash all the black frats and just like see if someone was ciphering, and I would just cipher rat. And then I met everybody. And then I met this dude, T, and he introduced me to Jay Rawls. And we met in the business college. And then we went to his house, recorded on a 4-track ASR-10. And that was the first time I ever recorded or was like, I'm writing a thing that's going to be recorded. And we did a bunch of songs. And then after that, I met Jell. And Scribble was right around there when I met Dibs. And Scribble was cool. You know, like, I battled... There was that Scribble. The first one in 97 was super righteous. It was me versus the heavy hitter, Source dudes, Rhymefest and Juice. And then me and Eminem were ripping people up. But all Eminem shit was written. That one was very climactic. But then the one where I battled Peace, after that, I was like, yeah, I don't want to do this anymore. Because if the highest echelon of battling is pretending to disrespect the rappers that formed me, it's not going to work.
Yeah.
You know, it felt super phony.
I saw
because
that.
I'm genuine.
Yeah. I saw the same thing with when Idea battled Peace. He kind of had that same, you saw him kind of hold back and was like, oh, this is somebody I've looked up to my whole life. And how can I just disrespect him? Like you said.
Yeah.
It's just, I don't know. I want to kill everyone, but not them, not my idols, not the guys that like put it in me, you know, like, it was like, I think You know, and then also I got more creative at the same time. Like this whole time, freestyling and battling and being unprepared was my art. And then I started to write and I was like, oh shit, this is a whole other fucking art that freestyling barely plays into. You know, and then after that, I started collaborating, making full lengths, and that became this other layer. So, you know, but battling was the best, man. I used to be a dick. I would serve fucking everybody, anybody that needed it. And I still feel that way. There's a lot of rappers that I just see, you know, it's the same principle of like, you meet someone, you can tell they've never been punched in the face. You can tell when a rapper has never been served.
How do you feel about the whole scene turning towards writtens? I mean, I don't like, personally, I don't like it. And it kind of upsets me to think, cause I like to freestyle and I don't like to think that someone's coming somewhere prepared, studied, did their homework and written down a bunch of shit because who knows if they can go the long distance. So that kind of always irks me. So how do you feel about that nowadays? Because everything's written.
Yeah, that's all it is now, right?
That's all it is.
Yeah, it's sort of like there is a tier, you know, that is serving someone. The composed tier is amazing, but the real width of the rapper, a lot of people can do that composed tier. Very few people can serve you on fucking spec. Yeah. You know what I mean? Yeah. And know nothing about you because you need it and they know how to do it, pull it out of the air. I will say though, some of the amazing execution over the years, you know, rest in peace, Caddy Ron and Daylight and all these other people. They destroy it. Some of that wordplay is fucking remarkable, and those dudes aren't really writing songs, so that's where you're going to hear that rap. So, like, when I hear that shit, I'm like, oh, that's inspiring rap. It makes me want to get a pen. So, the gun shit, I don't give a fuck about. It's all fiction, you know, but when they're drilling it, I love seeing somebody get dug into a hole, and when the written dudes are digging people into holes, it's a worse hole. It's, like, bad. You know, that said, though, what you were saying is my least favorite aspect, where it's like someone tells me I'm gonna battle someone and I got like 5 months to like research them and love them and like serve them out of research and affection. It's a little weird. Yeah. It's not my bag, you know. Yeah.
But it has made for some entertaining battles and made it to where we got to see, you know, I've always said like in the freestyle battles at Scribble, it wasn't always the two best at the in the final, because maybe the two best battled in the semifinal. You know what I mean? You didn't get to see the two best. We would get to see the two best at their best with these written battles, which was always fun and exciting. Good for numbers.
And it's important to say, like, on the East Coast, we definitely we had our own version. Like, in my crew, when I was younger, nobody listened except me to Fellowship, was aware that people were, like, coming completely off top all the time and, like, killing it, you know. And I wasn't even tape trading at the time when I started freestyling and battling well, you know. So I wasn't even aware of how good all of Project Blowed really was or anything. But so we had our own code about coming off top, but getting exposed to that shit gradually, it was interesting how, like, I just knew that somewhere in the world someone was that good. And I got exponentially better every time I rapped, because I was just mentally in a room with a fictional version of these people I just heard on a crusty ass tape, you know, because hearing that, they would just like pull chains off, getting loose, pulling shit further and further away, rhyming faster, saying weirder shit. And not everybody around me was hip with that, man. I was definitely the weird one. And I would always have to say I was Puerto Rican, so I didn't get fucking jumped because we were being white wasn't really the move.
Yeah,
I feel Puerto Rican, baby.
So you said something about tape trading. That was a big thing in the 90s, especially towards the late 90s. And that was a way that a lot of people, we've talked about, you know, people, underground artists putting their stuff on the B-side of a tape that had you know, Eminem on one side, or, you know, Dr. Dre on one side, and getting that tape out on the... Were you a big tape trader, and did you put your...
Yeah, I got a couple good stories. So all of Anticon is because of tape trading.
Yeah.
So we met... I met Dibs, of course, in the town in Cincinnati. We became besties very rapidly, and he had Gel, and we made Pressage together. But the whole time, he's like, "You're gonna love Gel." Gel has Kevin Beecham, who you may know from he's in Minneapolis now, down with Rhymesayers, and he's like,
still is and always has been like a magnet and magnate for all things rap. So he had all these tapes. So he sends shit with Jeff. He's like, oh shit, Dose, I heard Hemispheres. You got to bring him Atmosphere. So I get Overcast for the first time on tape and I'm blown away. God's Bathroom Floor.
And super hard.
It's the monsters that I conjure and the marijuana, yeah. Cat litter. Yeah. So that
on and on.
Like hear all that and I'm like, oh man, I want to be this guy, you know. And then at the same time, I had the Live Poets 12 inch, but then I got more tapes through Dibs, who played a show with the Live Poets, which was Soul and Alias, rest in peace, and Mayonnaise and Mood Swing. And then that all just kind of like happened, but that was literally all through tape trading and being interested. And then Pedestrian in Anticon, I lived with Y and I was constantly sending stuff to Pedestrian and he was sending stuff to me. And I had weird East Coast shit that was lost or that I dubbed or stole out of studios. And he sent me all the Blowed. And more importantly, because I had heard a bunch of that, I had all the Saphir, I had what was available, the Casual Battle. But what I didn't have was Circus and Radio Inactive, and the Shapeshifters. Jeez. And the Circus and Radio tapes changed my life, man. Oh. I definitely was like, yo, I gotta, they were just letting it all out. Like, you know, and so was my music, at times diuretic or whatever, but I was just like, yo, Circus doesn't give a fuck. Radio doesn't give a fuck. Radio styling, Circus always just like, the origami and the, just like,
Off some other shit,
dude. Yeah, really, yes. Inspiring. Yes. So, and then through tape trading, actually, I don't know if it's tape trading anymore. We're just kind of a lot closer at this point. We're giving each other dubs. It's a little different. Tape trading involves the mail and not really meeting someone, yes. In my humble opinion, you know. And then, but Slug gave me this tape that was sent to him, and it was Aesop. It was his, first works, and then I got in touch with him and met him, hung out with him, and then signed him to Mush, which, you know, fuck Mush, they like, he's got his records back now, but yeah. First time he got to put something out. So that was all through loving fucking tapes, and I have every single tape in the other room. They're all in great condition. I don't know what's on
that. Needs to be in a museum. Yeah. Like that stuff needs to be in a museum.
You still got
to
wait in
for history.
Like, do you got a tape player at the house?
Doesn't
matter. Pop
it
in?
Dude, I got a tape player in every room. I got a Kanye. I got the LL Cool J radio. With my video game money, the first thing I did was I was like, I want all the Ghetto Blasters I couldn't get when I was fucking 12. Yeah. Anyway, so lots of tape players. I actually listen to a lot of shit on tape. I got my rap collection is a little broader. I have a lot, but, you know, like all my Lord Finesse and fucking a lot of my early East Coast shit is on tape.
That's dope. So as you got
Cool G Rap.
That's cool.
So good.
You mentioned, you know, a couple Anticon guys, Alias, which I have an Alias shirt on tonight.
There you go.
Yes. Bless, man.
One of
I
my
miss
favorites,
him every day.
One of my favorites. How did the conversation for creating Anticon, you know, as a collective even come about, you know, and when did that come
And then
about?
How did you guys make your way to Berkeley? Because us being Northern California kids.
Or San Francisco, Berkeley, yeah.
That
yeah.
was like.
Okay, you guys are.
We're in like the Stockton area. So like we found Anticon, and that was the first time I heard, like, I felt like, oh my God, there's this other subgenre of hip hop that is unfound. For me, it was unfound. I got like, I got to show everybody this. Everyone needs
a
niche.
Hey, thank you. You know what I mean? You know, I think one of the things that's happened to our music, at least for me, I speak for myself here, is it's like remained something that became personal to people and therefore was like a secret. So there's this interesting, slower spread of the work, but better people, and it's taken in a realer space. So I'm appreciative, but it's this thing that I walk with, you know. So when Anticon started, and also with Anticon, all this is subjective. I don't remember so good. I've been on drugs my whole life. And, you know, everybody, it was so many human beings. Everyone's perspective and take on it is super valid, you know. It started right after we all met, tape trading. I think the bond was closest between Soul and I. I think Dibs told Soul, Dose is going to call you immediately and be fucking annoying and want to do music right away. And then Big Soul told me that the second I talked to him.
Which is true, right?
And that's what happened.
Yeah, a little bit. Yeah, I was like, yeah, let's do a song. So we just, you know, we started bonding. That's how Jeff and I were rolling. Buck, 65, all these dudes. And we all just were connected and more than anything wanted to start a label. And then we took Greyhound buses out and made Deep Puddle. And Slug already had Rhymesayers, so it wasn't really about who's in, who's out, what the fuck it was. But after that, we decided that we wanted a home to put things out. And that felt really good to me because when I did Hemispheres, and Soul had the same thing with his first vinyl, you could go to Fat Beats or TRC, right? Fat Beats was all East Coast. They actually, Eclipse was just straight ghosting me. Everybody was like, nah, not even, you know? And then TRC, they called me up and they said, hey, this isn't hip hop. That's fucking Hemispheres, bro. Yeah. That's what they told me. They didn't take the record. Then this dude who wears raver pants, Charles, I'm sorry, Charles. I think that's your fucking name. I apologize. I don't remember shit.
Chuck, sorry, Chuck. We forgot your name.
Shout out, Chuck.
Chuck of the Raver Pants. But he put it on. Yeah. He gave us a P&D. He took the Hemispheres. He took the 1000. They went super fast. That was all there ever was. So that became this thing where Soul and I were both trying our best to do business. Then Soul and Pedestrian were together in California. Yoni and I were still in Cincinnati, Jeff still in Chicago, and they called me one night on this ugly green phone we had in the Green Think Mansion, and they were like, we got this name, Anticon. We were like, all right.
That's right.
You know, it just felt right. And then the plans, we did a couple trips out to California to record stuffed animals and shit, and just be loose while Soul gets all the credit for founding. I mean, Sue was meager, but he did it. You know, he got this. It was a 3-bedroom apartment with 11 human beings in it. Wow. It was fucking nasty. Yeah, including Bren and his wife, Jen. It was a lot. So, and then we all went out there in a few waves and moved out whenever we got money. You know, like none of us had any money. We don't really come from it. So we all had to wait for weird shit. Jeff had like a telemarketing job. I got like $800 from Mush. You know, it was fucking... Wow. We had nothing. And then we all worked temp jobs, lived in this house, recorded all the time. Definitely some of the best times and years of my life. We were a fucking nonstop hip hop sleepover of absolute stupidity. It was pretty wild.
Underground machine. You guys were just pumping out
a lot of energy,
project
too,
after project after project.
Yep. Having a lot of fun, meeting all the people that inspired us once we were in Cali. And then, you know, we came to Cali. That was like executive decision that Soul Brandon made, came to the Bay specifically because Quantum, because Souls, because Legends, absolutely. They were flourishing there. Why not? We all came from fucked up places. I was in Cincinnati, came from Jersey and Philly. I was like, yeah, let's do it. I got like an odd wallet of carrot juice. I thought it was another planet, man. My first California week, but you know, it was great, and it opened us. We all needed it because we had a lot of walls. We all had been trying to get into music and be in the way we were, and those walls came down rapidly as we got together and huddled around, like being creative. And I don't know, it was definitely like a soulmate affair, you know. And then we all lived together too long. And we all had to get space and get the fuck out of there. That shit was way too much.
What happens with your best friends? I've moved out with my best friend right away, and immediately, like. You know what I mean? We hated each other for a while, but you get over it. It's brotherly love, right?
Yeah. Yeah. It's too true. You know, and I think that was all a part of it. And you can't, I think like the great, we all could tap into being better, faster, graduating our own selves individually, stylistically, artistically, because we were amplifying one another and seeing one another take leaps. And even when you were out of juice or leaps to take, it would just kind of happen, you know, and that was super important. But then what happens because of that is you got to become an individual and you got to focus on where you're going. So it's like, you know, you have that space and you actually learn how to drive your creativity and be the shit to yourself. And then you have to go somewhere with that. And it takes individual questing and shit.
Just coming up with your whole rhyme scheme and style, where did that come about? You just, you know what I mean? It's wicked. It's wicked. That's all that I can put on it. So how did that even come about and someone be like, dude, yeah, do that shit?
And how did you evolve it from Hemispheres to the style?
Yeah,
because
the Hemispheres,
it's morphed a lot.
Yeah.
Yeah, Hemispheres is, when I started, I sounded like Guru. to be clear. Like, I was like a little guru Buckshot Shorty thing. I don't know what was going on.
You're spitting hard.
Yeah, and I was, you know, I never move my top lip when I rap. That shit, it was very East Coast at the time. And then, I'll be honest, man, you know, I heard things, it was all West Coast material for the, I mean, don't get me wrong, the GZA, I wrote 1,000 raps because of Liquid Swords, you know, like that penmanship was all that shit, that era, that East Coast era was super revolutionary. But then I heard fucking, it was like the thing that really blew my mind besides Fellowship was Saphir. I fucking heard Boxcar Sessions. I heard him on Body Hats, the third Digital Underground record. And I was, because they always bring a new dude. And I was like, oh my God, the new Tupac is better than the old Tupac. I was like, who is this dude? And he was just killing it. That unorthodox shit, which Micah Jupe actually is, Self Jupiter is one of the people who I think is one of the only other people on that tier with Saphir, where you actually can't see what's coming. You know, I think with Micah, you can't either, but he's sticking a melody and a cadence, which locks a groove a lot more. Yeah. And like, you know, he does some more eccentric shit, but like, there's this thing about Saphir and Jupe where you don't know what's happening. And like, I heard that and I was like, ah, oh, I got to reboot. I got to have no father to my style. I got to be unpredictable. And then I heard the Saphir Casual Battle. And even though that's all majority written, the Pencil Neck Piss Collar Gumby and fucking Fresh Prince of Bel Air with a Slang Dictionary. And like, I just was like, yeah, that's how I want to talk to people. Yeah. I want to sound like their mother meets the street. And I want to really take away their masculinity. I want to get them in that vulnerable spot that they wake up in, not the one when they put the backwards hat, you know, like. And so I heard that shit, and then that kind of seeped in. And really, it was Saphir. And then it took me a bunch of recording, almost all of Hemispheres and the shit before that, to loosen up and to get out of my own way. And I just mean recording, like how to get off paper, get in my head and kill a take and do a better song. Because I've always been someone that, even before I was cool on record, you would see me in a cipher and you'd be like, who's that Puerto Rican dude? You know, and then after that, it happened on the other shit, you know. So, and then just like getting open with a free, I got really addicted to styling on record, preparing it and drilling it in a take and like rolling my eyes back in my head. And because that's not really something you totally do freestyling, but really eventually that shit was like, I mean, I still do it. There's parts on the new Alpha, where I just, you know, I just leave verse for fucking 48 seconds. And it's my favorite shit on the, everything else is boring. I'll be honest. I do a lot of cool stuff. It's all boring compared to like the high of fast rap.
You've really nailed that unique sound. I mean, you don't sound like anybody else. And when you hear a song, you know right away, oh, that's Doseone.
Yeah.
There's other rappers where you listen to, especially nowadays, that you hear them and you couldn't tell them apart from, you know, and another person.
All the auto-tune and everybody sounds the
same.
You
definitely. And for you to even, you
know, doesn't help.
No, it doesn't help. You nailed it too with the Self Jupiter too, like the not being able to guess where he's going, not just with his wordplay, but with the rhythm of what he was saying. Yep. And I can totally see that in your style now too. Like that totally opened my eyes right there.
Yeah. And also, to be fucking clear, all the times I freestyle with Peace, I was around him a bunch in the Bay. I have some very NSF podcast stories about Peace, but he's him freestyling is the lesson, man. If you've never freestyled with Peace, you are not ready. He is the only dude, except Micah, where they finish rapping in the circle, and then it's my turn, and I'm like, oh, I rap. Like, they take me out of it. The shit is so good. I'm like, God damn. Peace has this ability to, like,
he gets better as he goes, right?
Yes. And in the, like, field in the mind that is milliseconds between saying one thing and another, he has this, like, 20-sided die thing where he just rolls what he was talking about all the way across thinking and says something else that he makes work. because he has a relationship with that shit, man. He has a deep relationship with pulling from the brain into the rhythm and all that shit. And you really, I think that's one of the things I really saw in Peace was like, I have a lot of talent with that and I put a lot of work in and I get out of, I try to like go there. And I was like, wow, this dude's better. He's like a lot better. He has more talent at it. He like that God of getting open likes him more. It's like his favorite dude. You know what I'm saying? There was just, there was shit where it literally puts me in my place, which is a very good thing because it always pushed me. But like being around that shit, and then there's like, you know, like a lot of underground cats, guys that are probably dead now. There's been a lot of people that have gotten open like that in front of me. Not just those dudes, but they're the ones, man. Micah too. The second he starts rapping, you're like, wow.
Coolest dude in the room.
Pretty cool. This you got to keep cool. It cool.
Hell yeah. Staying on the topic of freestyling, you know, I've definitely seen that video, or I guess it's a it's like a story about you teaching freestyling to, you know, kids and stuff. Inner city kids. How did you get involved with that, man? And, you know, is that something you're still kind of involved with? Or, you know, how long were you doing that for? And how did you get involved with all that? It's pretty dope.
Yeah, I was dating an amazing lady who had friends who ran a community outreach program, which I went to, and it was underprivileged kids from the Bay and Richmond area. It's called YMR, Youth Movement Records. And then eventually the video you probably saw was when we were located in Oakland School of the Arts, OSA, downtown. We were in some other shitty building for a while. But they called me in to speak to the kids. Mm. And so I go in to talk to the kids, and it goes pretty well. And then at the end, they're like, hey, we got to cut this. We got freestyle class. And I was like, can I stay? You know, and then I just stayed. I met Kev, who was the instructor. And I was just like, you know, I want to do this too. We really didn't add structure. I think the really interesting thing was we just let these kids light themselves up. And you could tell it was the most they liked a classroom experience, period. And they probably were having a hard time with all that shit. So we just kept it super open. We diffused battles. We also let them battle, you know, like in a more organized way. They said the damnedest shit. What was my favorite? The dude's line that was my favorite. It was, rappers are confused like they just became parents. Oh. Come on, truth. Bro. Some I shut truth. The whole cypher down. I was like, that's it. We're done for the day.
This guy gets it. A+.
Yeah, man. Kill his heart. And, you know, so I did it for several years. I loved it. I brought beat makers in. We would play drums live. I tried to expose them to different music. Yeah. I showed them This Is the Life. You know, I showed them Latif, Lyrics Born. I basically, it would be a small bit of exposing them to freestyling that I could get copies of, evidence of, you know, and then compose stuff. And they honestly, even though a lot of them were listening to, like, I would say the most interesting thing they liked at that time was Lupe Fiasco. They were listening to all kinds of like pre-drill shit, just little clips. Yeah. I don't really know. A lot of bass shit, of course, you know. But nobody was styling, and I show them styling, and that fucking cipher, they're styling.
Changed everything,
Changed your lives, probably.
And also, what I loved is they didn't need 2 months on the bike, man. The good kids just heard that shit, and they were like, all right. Yeah. And they would just go across the lane, and then it kind of stuck, and they would revolve between like being understood in the current cadence of rap, and then like styling, you know.
I think it's a pretty awesome way to, for one, give back to the community, and then two, give kids or the youth another outlet to utilize other than whatever, fucking around in the streets and this and that, you know, turning something negative into a positive, man. So that's pretty awesome.
Yeah, give them some time. I want to do it in Santa Fe. There's like a this very white environment, but there is a strong indigenous community, and I'm just waiting to find the right connects because I imagine in some way I can help them, whether it's utilizing Ableton or maybe motherfuckers rap. I don't really know, but I would like to get back into it on that level. But for me, I think it's important to plug in a way that I didn't have it when I was a fucked up kid. I would have loved to have something like that. So I don't really want to do it at like Sunny Day, Brookshire Academy.
To a
bunch of people with saddle shoes. I'm not being weird about it, but I actually would. If I'm going to take that time out of my life and do it pro bono, I want to give it to people that like need to find creativity.
For sure, you gotta do it right. Gotta do it right, man. I also saw like Gel was in there, you know, on the beat machine and maybe on the turntables or whatever, busting out some beats. Now you started producing too. How is you know, that stemming from just being with Gel and doing a number of albums as themselves together and just being around him and other producers so often? Or, you know, how did you take up producing yourself?
Yeah, it was, you know, I'm a good mimic. Mm-hmm. And I'm not scared of, I'm scared of some shit, but I'm not really scared of a lot of creative, you know, avenues. So I just try it. I do it poorly till I don't. And then I'm very aware of if I have talent or if I'm wasting my fucking time, you know, like I've tried enough. So anyway, being around Gel, and then I was not really a producer. I, of course, always use beat machines. I think I struggled to like trim samples correctly. I don't know what I couldn't get. And then I got in to Dawes. And once I got, once I could see music in a linear fashion, it was more than being a beat maker. I was like, wow, I'm a producer. I just had to spend time knowing nothing so that I could know a little. So through Subtle, working with Jordan, the drummer, I was basically the producer along with him, running the sessions, making ideas, doing drops, coming up with ideas for composition and stretching. Then I started using Ableton more, making beats in there. Now I use all kinds of shit and I'm not scared. And I taught myself how to make music because Jeff is self-taught and Dax is self-taught. Mm-hmm. And so that was a huge jump, was seeing Dax play keyboards.
Yeah, for sure.
And he's just fucking murdering it. And he is totally self-taught.
Yeah.
And so he thought he was, he just let me, something about that let me learn. Whereas classes, shit like that has never been my bag. And then I just made a million fucking things. Suck until you don't.
You're even making soundtracks for video games and shit now, right?
Yeah, it's my kind of, you know, to not mince words, I feel a lot of musicians from my era, you either blew up and were Modest Mouse size, right? And you're still okay. Or you did not. And that's a lot of really brilliant people. Really generous people, hardworking people that had their value sort of abstracted before it was actualized. So I feel like I was in severe debt and I had to get a gig, which was doing sound design for video games. Mm-hmm. My debt was not from cocaine and fun. It was from just doing music and going hard and being the mom of a lot of shit. So yeah. And then now after a whole fuck ton of work and a bunch of great relationships and opportunities that came from music. So the guys who made Enter the Gungeon, Dodge Roll, they knew, they love battle rap. They love Idea, rest in peace. And they were like, we love you. And I got a shot to do music for that game and it changed my life. So now I see my value times 10 because I get a small percentage of revenue share that I work super hard for because I do about three times the work of an album as well as help write and whatever else. Basically, like, it's just this whole thing where I'm like, yo, this endeavor is going to treat me right. You get full access to all my shit. Yeah. I'll fucking name it all. I'll sit in the back and I'll say shit. I'll do whatever the fuck you want, you know? So that same way that I went at being a avant rap music dude, I do it here. And it's just like, great people, great relationships, no bullshit. Industry's still here. Nothing is... streaming, it's great, you know. So
and the money comes in on time,
and the money's amazing, man. Yeah. And you know what I do with it is, it'd be generous and just enjoy that. I'm fucking grateful, you know. So just I'm happy about my gig. I make a bunch of games, and then I'm really good at it. So now the big thing too, after Anticon closing, the music industry sucking all the dicks together, tied with rope, and losing Bren, losing Alias. Right after Les's Orchestra, I was like,
horrible time.
Yo, yeah, I was just like, this amazing journey went dark, you know what I mean? And I was like, how do I get back to this thing I love? So the big move for me, Alpha 2, marks like the beginning of a new chapter where it's like, I love making records, having best friends, truly connecting, going the distance, pulling something out of the ether, making this thing, right? I fucking hate everything else
yeah.
that was added after that point. But I needed to do it to create a career, to create a cyclical revenue, to be out with the homies, to blow up, to fucking do stuff, to meet all these great people like the No Twist in Germany. So like that shit needed to be done. But now, surgically removing all that career garbage, motherfuck your interviews, your photo shoots, fuck all of that crap, just records and anonymity. That's really what I'm about. I can't. The rest of it is maybe not a waste of everyone's time, but it is truly a waste of mine.
Yeah.
Yeah. Does that go with playing shows? How do you feel about live performance and stuff like that?
Yeah. You know, it's like, I think, so I was going to do a 13 and God reunion in Germany. Because they wanted to do it and they had a festival, but then it got canceled because of funding and bullshit.
Yeah.
So I said yes to that. Things like that. If it feels right to me, I'll get it together for that because that can be beautiful. But yeah. I don't ever need to see a fucking Texaco in Omaha again.
And on a human level, I understand that so much because you can only do so much for so long on the road and not have the return, the juice be worth the
diminishing
squeeze.
Returns. Yeah. You know, no, it's, and you know, the other thing too is like, I really, when I go out and do something live, I like to be fucking blisteringly tight and know that I'm killing it and doing something good. Mm-hmm. And now I like making music all the time and doing all these games. My days are like full of pushing myself to bring something out of the ether. Mm-hmm. I don't want to cut that off for 6 days in a car going to fucking Toronto. God bless Toronto. I don't believe God, but you're amazing Toronto. But I don't want to go.
So as a fan, it breaks my heart because we want to see you live. As a fan. But
I'll do some stuff, you know. But just make sure you go. If I say I'm doing it, just know between us.
Especially you don't want to be there, and you're like, who the fuck is this?
Why am I here?
No, as a human, I totally fucking agree with you. I could see that, and at my age, I'm in my mid 30s, and I would not want to be out on the fucking road right now.
No, fuck,
you know what I mean.
And there's a hard truth that I used to say back when I was touring that still is with me, and not in like a bitter, funky way, but just the reality is I used to say sometimes that we would go on tour and we weren't seen, we were missed because we had half cap in all these places. Mm-hmm. And JJ, Jell and I and all the other beautiful human beings I toured with, we did an absolute decade, 3 to 4 tours a year. We went everywhere and we were missed in half of those venues. SMD.com. I'll catch you later. I'm sorry. Y'all got a time travel. I don't know what to say. We were out there.
Did it.
That effort for me, but I'm not like something about that is just as true to me that we were missed. And that's an important way to look at it as is. Yeah, I don't feel like going to Texaco.
One of my favorite live performance moments by you wasn't even at one of your shows. It was at an Idea and Ability shows. One of the last, they were promoting Bite the Throat at Bottom of the Hill in San Francisco. You were in the crowd, and like at the end of the show, Idea just calls you up on the stage. And I'm pretty sure you two were just freestyling back and forth. It was just fucking awesome, bro. Like that was a rare moment that, you know.
Hip-hop history to be there
and witness.
That's my guy. I mean, like, rest in peace. I can't speak for Mikey, but I know I love Max very much, too, abilities.
Mm-hmm.
But, the energy I was bringing to rap, which I was gathering from all the people I was meeting in rap. I didn't invent shit. I just was like stealing what was fucking new to me and amazing and that I could steal.
Everyone else is doing as well.
When I met.
Yeah.
Say
what everyone else was doing as well. You know, you're
a bunch sponging is the nice way. Stealing is hard, term. But I met Mikey and he was fucking 16 and he was amazing, off top, breakdancing, doing everything at once. And he got a lot. My glow amplified his and he just took that and rolled with it. And I didn't see him as much as I like. We got to do a few things. Yeah, and then we got to connect again way later, right before he passed. We did a whole tour together, and it was really beautiful. Him and Max and me and Jeff are motherfucking peas in different pods. Yeah. And, man. And also, he's one of the few that can really get open, like freestyle. Most gifted, did the work and the gift times a million. You know,
for sure.
A performer, artist,
poet,
yeah,
for sure.
Much like yourself, exactly. Why you guys probably gelled so well?
Yeah, definitely.
Before we jump into your newest projects with Alpha, your newest group, let's just talk a little bit about some more hip hop history, real quick. You're a man that's been involved with many different groups, bro. 13 and God, Subtle, Themselves, Deep Puddle Dynamics, et cetera, et cetera. I'm forgetting so many. What was the energy like in that room? And how long did it take to make, you know, A Taste of Rain, Why Kneel with Deep Puddle Dynamics? You know, how long did it take to record that? And then what was the energy like, man? Because that's a straight hip hop history right there.
This is another one where I'm going to say some words. Mm. But if you read numbers that are different, those are right. Mm. I don't really remember exactly how long we were there and all this shit. But we all took Greyhound buses out. We met. Yeah. We had all these electric phone calls. I think we did whatever it's called, three-way. We did fucking three-way phone call back in the day. Proto phone for the internet.
Yeah. Yeah.
We were like, let's do these songs about these things. And I was probably the dick that said most of the like inaccessible things, like we're a candle. And that but it was great, man, because that's a terrible way to describe what we were trying to do. I think what was valid is we were trying to do a concept record without avoiding all the like cliche violent terms, you know, which at that time we were sort of just after the Versace era, like the Junior Mafia, boot camp was great, but you know, just like bullshit, guns, clothing was getting really shitty. So we wanted to do something where none of that was in it, but it was all conceptual. We kind of stuck with it, made it cool, and we didn't say our name. It wasn't like I'm Slug and I'm Dose, none of this crap. So that was really it. So we came up with a bunch of topics that we met in Minneapolis, had like one of the best experiences of my life. We had all really hadn't met. We met at a show before on the way. We fucking slept on floors in Slug's house. I met Abuse. I don't know if you know Abuse. He's an insane artist. He did the Anticon Ant. And he was another tape trader who had like a bunch of shit I actually didn't have. Like at the time, I guess I never had Eli's As They Pass, I think was the first one.
Yeah.
And so he gave me that and a bunch of Soul shit I didn't have, even though I was there on a trip with Soul. I was like, oh, I don't have those five songs. So we were just like... still trading, staying up all night, writing raps, meeting for the first time. I think it was about 2 weeks. It couldn't have been more. And then we did some separate sessions later. The last four songs were done a little more piecemeal after. Yeah. So, but yeah, man, me and Bren wrote our verses for the Make It Rain song that's like on the 12-inch or whatever.
Yeah.
On Slug's porch on this rainy day. Mm. And it was great. And Bren came out of his shell in that experience. Mm-hmm. I wouldn't know because I just met him. You know what I mean? I just met like new Bren, you know, and it was amazing, man. It was a real highlight of life. And then we all went back to our shitty places we lived and like listened to the dubs and the mixes. And then when we finished that record, we were like, we got to start a label. This is important.
Yeah. Collectively, man, you guys together, beautiful music.
Some would say, I mean, that even kickstarts Slug to go to Rhymesayers and create a Rhymesayers label, right?
Well, no, they were already, so Rhymesayers had already existed. They did Overcast. And really, everything, you know, I'll be clear, like they had an amazing community. Mm. Probably the most developed I had ever seen, and Cincinnati's was pretty good. Mm. Out East, my experience was never the word community. That's a Midwest thing where like there's like a bunch of different color and kind of people together making hip hop because they really want it in their place. You know what I'm saying? In the city, in the cities where I grew up, it was fucking dog eat dog.
Competitive.
Yeah, I don't know about the word community. Crew, maybe. You can get one C word, but you're not going to get community. And but he really had that. Rhymesayers was like this from fucking Jump Street, man. I went out there, I met everybody, you know, Musab and Sadiq, of course, and Bird, and like everybody was there and helping each other. Everything was in Sadiq's house. Wow. I don't think he does that anymore.
No,
I think he's balling now. I don't think he lets you record sleep in his living room.
Yeah. I think he stepped up a little bit since then. Yep. So let's just jump into the new project, man. Alpha, your new crew or group with Mestizo, it's you and Mestizo. You guys released your first album, self-titled album in 2017, I want to say. Yep. Super dope. Since then, you guys have released a second project. I think it's just titled 2, and yep. That was released in November. Let's talk a little bit about that, man. How did this project come about, and how did Alpha form? Because, dude, it's so refreshing to know and to hear you still making music, man, for one, you know. Two, how did this beautiful creativity come about?
So, Zoe and I met when he was like 16, and I think his rap name was Yoda, and he was in an MC battle. I think it was Tucson. Again, if you see other words or numbers, that's what's right, not me. Yeah. And so Jeff and I did a themselves show there when Jeff used to put the SP-1200 in a duffel bag with no padding and take it places before we did anything really. And did the show, and then he was in the battle, and his energy was great, and we were freestyling. And then a million years later, I met him as Mestizo in Machina Muerte, you know, and he was rapping all the time in LA. And I didn't really know, but then we reconnected. And then I heard his music around that time. You know, I just re-saw him and remembered him. Mm-hmm. But it's not like he played me all his music in that instance. So and then I was like, this dude is nasty. And then over time, even though we're very different people, we are the same shark. And we are, that's why it's Alpha. It's just this thing that, even though I got cats and he's got kids, fucking sharks. And we let each other do that. We have each other's back. There is something that I did not have in Anticon. In Anticon, I was the only battler. So there was a lot of bullshit with like some of the other contemporary crews calling us, you know, the F word and like, but never to my face, you know. It was like everybody picked their battles, you know. Yeah. And meeting someone like Mestizo, we really have that in common. It's like creative, sure, but guard dog, you know? And so we just kind of fucking let that out. We get each other's back. We're in a new space. We can actually be vulnerable. Mm-hmm. Violently vulnerable is what I feel is the best thing about the best parts of Alpha 2. It's not like old man in a chair rap, but it's distinctly like hitting you, drilling you in the heart. Yeah. And it's some real shit, you know? And we do it like it's bars, you know, but we just have a really good connection. All we do is do a verse. The other dude hears it and does another verse. And then with this record, one of the struggles was on the first record, we went through producers just trying to find the right person. And at the end, we found, of course, Bren Alias, and then he passed away. And I actually have a bunch of beats that were supposed to be for the second Alpha that was staying in the iTunes forever, you know, but so that we waited. That happened to coincide with me just processing his passing and being in that, you know, about all the other shit. And then Mediogre is like Mestizo's gel. So his best friend for a long time, his right-hand man, made all his beats on an SP-1200. And Meaty just came with a fucking ton of heat. And JJ and I are a nightmare, dude. JJ and I hadn't spoke for 18 months. And then this email starts with 10 beats. And we made the record in 6 weeks.
Jeez. Wow, you know. Fast. That's when you know you're
of course
yeah
you're rolling. Yeah, it gets assembled and mixed after that, but like flowing. the tag of both of us, like it started with like I was super busy and I'm like, yo, I can't be fucking sitting here rapping all day editing this shit, you know. And then next thing I know, I'm just behind on work, and all I'm doing is fucking rapping every morning at 6 a.m It's great.
You got extra bars, you got tons of lyric and content, you're like, hey, we need to make another album.
Yeah, so we're working on 3 now. We got an amazing posse cut and a new song that's like a long song that we're putting out and a video in the next couple months here. And then we're going to start working on this 3. And then that's it, man. We just fucking
trifecta.
Ride or die. Yeah, and we're super good to each other. We don't have shitty expectations about stuff. We just approach this music. That shit I was expressing earlier about me wanting to just do music and move.
Yeah.
They're good with that, and that's what I need. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah, yeah. So I heard in like another interview, you said you took the money out of the equation. It's just now about making the music, you know. So you're not afraid to do whatever, put out different.
Yeah, and also, you know, I'm like I fucking ran a label, 5 labels. I don't know. So like making it not the negative pennies is really easy. The expectations that like come after that are actually about marketing and business and the world's reception of it. Mm-hmm. And that's where I'm like, hey, yo, homies, I love you. I'll do another record tomorrow, but like, I ain't trying to market, you know? It's a, what I like most about all the music I found is that I found it. This may not be the best business plan for a man of my stature to adopt, but it's, I'm not about a business plan right now. I actually want my music to have that relationship to people, to be a bunch of shit you can dig up for a while.
Yeah, for sure.
And that mindset, I guess, is in history a true artist mindset. And you are somebody that dabbles in a lot more than just music art. You are, you know, I've seen you
painting,
you do graphic, you've done a lot of your cover art. You've done cover art for some other artists like Jell too. Talk a little bit about how you got into painting and doing your cover art, and because that's always I always love that about a rapper or an MC, somebody that does the music, the beat, the cover art, you know what I mean?
Multi-hats.
The whole project is his.
Yeah, multi-hats.
Tell me a little bit about how you got into that, because I love that part. And obviously, that's the artistic mind that you have, that mindset of, you know, sometimes you're going to lose a penny by not doing what's culturally right, but you're going to do what's right for yourself.
Yeah, and I think that so that all that jazz starts from being like slightly visually adept from tagging and having black mm-hmm. books, right? Mm-hmm. So I was doing that for a million years. So I don't know, space letters or something. And then, and I would spray paint and, you know, pick colors and shit. But then the real cement was meeting two artists, I guess three. Y was, before he really rapped and made music, he painted all the time and did all this shit. And we lived together. And he was just like, it was just a comfortability with being creative that, like, I came, the only creativity we had violence and we had creativity. And it was all hip hop. And when you were doing that creativity, you didn't like slunch your body or do weird shit or like really be yourself. It was always guarded, less posturing. Being around Y, man, he was just an artist painting, and I started to loosen up. I saw what he did. Then this dude, Five, who used to go by Drain, who was a scribble jam graffiti writer, is probably my favorite of all time. He was just fucking mind-blowing, doing bombing. I've never seen painting faces on telephone poles. And then Adnostam, who's the producer, before he was really the producer for Cloud Dead and doing all his own shit. I mean, he was making beats on his SP-202, but he was painting and drawing. And he was fucking brazenly, like, into it. And he would just do it. And he would just paint in front of me, inspired. Like the 71 painting and shit that's one of the covers, still on my wall over here.
Wow.
But, I just saw that and I was like, I want to do it. And then he was the one too that was, he did music and he did the art for it. And then Yoni started doing that. And then I was like, I want to do that. I want to spend time. As I finish a record, I start looking at the world for what the square is mm-hmm. and the other squares and all that shit. And some of my art is better than others, but what the fuck are you going to do? Again, self-taught. I don't give a shit. You know, I think it represented things well. Definitely unique in the greater scheme of hip hop at the time and music in general. Because I was a fan after working at Amoeba of cover art and art in general. So I sort of stopped thinking about my rap record mm-hmm. and started thinking about my record in the store, you know?
Yeah.
So
one thing I've always been intrigued by is all the different Anticon, the old school like album covers, you know, and just the different weird little paintings or drawings that they had on the fronts of them.
Always,
yeah, there was a
super artistic,
yeah, like a lot of doodling, yada, a lot of Yoni shit,
yeah.
You know, it was cool. And then I think, honestly, the thing that I saw in Anticon, all the way up until its end with artists like Bats or Young Fathers mm-hmm. or The More Shallows or you know, Serengeti, of course, is yeah. that it wasn't about rap, it was about bedroom music. Mm-hmm. We gave people a chance who made bedroom music, you know, and it wasn't this big thing until it was, you know, and a lot of people had to go to great lengths to like be dope in the bedroom. And we, those people found us, we found them, we put their music out where we could. And I think that was really what Anticon was to me, was a thing that the only barriers to entry were like being unique in yourself and something that impressed us, you know, and we had to grow to allow more people to be received by us. This all sounds very hippie the way I'm talking right now, but we literally did. Like, at first, we just loved rap. I worked at Amoeba. I showed everybody Boards of Canada. We started growing from there. Yoni liked some good music, but like Lamb Chop, but I didn't. I'm not going to listen to that shit. You know, so it's, so it's interesting, you know, and we just grew. Everybody grew their tastes, opened to more shit, started receiving things. Some things a hit and blended with our existing audience. Some things not so much. And, you know, I think it was like, is definitely something I'm glad I was a part of, was giving voice to people's voice. It is also something I will not do again.
Yeah, you've made your mark, and we're very happy that you did. You definitely, someone that we looked up to, like we said, when we were younger, and it was definitely, when we heard, when I personally heard that music, I realized that this is, you know, like something that you could be a part of. It felt like a community. It mm-hmm. felt, you know, it felt different. It was just different.
That's great to hear. Yeah. And so, did you guys go to Rico shows? Did you make it to any Rico's Loft shows?
No,
we did not.
I did not.
Okay. Those were just great. That was like the very beginning of Anticon. They were like horrible sound.
Yeah.
The but best, we did a cover night.
When it sounds like shit.
My favorite night ever.
I went to a lot of Anticon shows, like in San Francisco, bottom of the hill, just small little joints, bro. Like, you know.
That's the era right after, you know, and that was also great shows. Mm. And I think we were you got better performances, I'll say that.
Uh-huh.
But
you didn't get the ground floor.
You know, we would like do a new routine every night, all of us. Yeah. And then we would bring up people from LA, various Blowed members and other people. And then one time we did cover night, and we all did covers. And Soul did all of, it's not Don't Curse, but he did a posse cut, Heel. You know, the posse cut Heel with Queen Latifah and Miss Melody.
I don't think so.
Has like 12 rappers. It's like a self-destruction predecessor. Okay. Came after that. Right. It's about healing. Has KRS-One. Okay. And Soul did everyone's verse. But he only knew the lyrics for like two. Man, it was just the funniest shit. I did Rampage by EPMD with Kirby Dominant. And I had to be both members of EPMD, and he was just LL, and he fucking blanked on LL's verse, so I had to be LL too.
Oh no.
It was just the best night, man. It was sloppy. AWOL did a fucking, what did AWOL? Oh man, he killed it. It was so good. Circus was there.
Out of the box shit, man. Out of the box shit. I remember a Pedestrian was dressed up as like a priest or whatever, and you're just like fucking going over the whole thing.
Yeah, that was a time Brandon was on one. So before that, Pedestrian would freestyle. They did this thing, Babylonians, where they would just freestyle, and he was white folks, and he would just serve you in the car. You'd like go piss in his apartment, and he'd push the door open and start serving you. He was like that like being that character became Evangelist JB Best. Mm-hmm. But he was merciless, man.
Yeah.
And it was so funny. Like, I battled well, but I would just let him serve me because I would cry laugh because he was so good at this.
Yeah,
lost breaking. East Coast white Craig Mack. I don't know. He was like Old Dirty meets Craig. I don't know what this character was, but it was something to get served by.
We have a buddy. We used to smoke weed, and we'd be like, "Hey," he would mimic the Pedestrian, you know, and we'd be like, "Hey, do the Pedestrian, do the Pedestrian," and he would start doing it, you know. So we just start busting up, bro. Yeah, it was just awesome, you know.
That's so great.
As we wind down here, man. What are you listening to these days? Like, you know, what do you find bumping in your car, or
what's inspiring you?
Yeah. Oh, so, I mean, right now the CD in the car is Ultra, Big Time, Kool Keith and Tim Dog. Rest in peace, Tim Dog, my favorite.
Yeah.
The heart of hip hop.
Mm-hmm. Hell yeah.
May you never die. And then I listened to this year, Buck 65, King of Drums, was fucking phenomenal. Definitely. I love Billy Woods and Elucid.
Yeah,
all the shit that they do. Pretty much, I mean, you know, it goes without everybody does.
Mm-hmm.
I'm not a joiner, I'm an appreciator. You know, like all that backwoods shit is like done right. Prem Rock and everyone and Curly, who I met briefly with a Logic at a show in the Bay, and I never would have got to meet them. You know, they're all the real deal. They're like cut from the cloth, doing it their way, deeply appreciative. I love Ka. But that's been a while now. And I knew him from Natural Elements, but the new Ka is where it's at. What else? Rap wise, Fatboy Sharif is great. I listen to, you know, Jid is kind of fucking amazing.
Yeah.
I can't hate.
Yeah,
that's probably the shiniest, poppest. He's not that pop, but that there's a lot of shit that I listen to him and I'm like, oh, this motherfucker is nasty. You know?
What do you think?
And then,
go ahead. What do you think of Kendrick Lamar? A lot of people are, you know, saying that he's like the top guy of his generation and
the new Tupac kind of deal. Yeah.
Kind of, sorry, yeah.
Oh, Tupac, what, the new Micah 9? I don't know. He's not. Tupac is garbage. He definitely is the guy of his generation though. I actually didn't. So when I started styling, making cool music, there are other people that are doing it, namely like Latif, Lyrics Born, Gift of Gab, the Blow guys, you know. Company Flow at the time, all these guys, right? Mm-hmm. But I didn't think that mainstream stalwarts would ever possess or be allowed to wield that kind of ownership and creativity at a maximal level and do what the fuck they want, and as a result be unpredictably impressive and dope. Yeah. And like I write off pop rap is just like, it's like country. I'm a horrible person. If you put on country around me, I start freestyling over it and like whatever. Yeah. You're over here. I do the same thing with rap. I can't handle it. It's too predictable.
Yeah.
Kendrick is not. Kendrick's amazing. I love it. I think he's a fucking win, man, for the greatest game of rap. I cannot say that about everything that is immensely popular. Kendrick is like someone where you would be like, oh, did this guy listen to Soul Sides and Anticon? And the answer is no, but he's amazing. Yeah. And he might as well have, but it's like the kids that I showed Latif. And then that afternoon, they're fucking styling. It's a something that he tapped into, you know? And I think it's great because he's like around shit like the game, you know? Which I know he'll beat me, he'll choke slam me, but that shit is remedial. It's remedial. It's, you know, it's like, what it is.
It's almost like Kendrick was at the Good Life at some point, you know what I mean? Like he could have been in that house and probably held his own fucking, you know what I mean? They wouldn't have passed the mic.
Yeah. And it's important to remember that every once in a while you can just come out of the void and be as dope as the best that ever were. And if you have the right support around you and you can get recognized, it's a good thing. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
It makes me think about all of the post-Micahs that there are that nobody knew about that got shot or dropped or are a mechanic now.
Yeah.
Because not everybody got Kendrick's twists, you know what I'm saying? Or mine, you know? So it's like, I don't know. I'm fucking down for that. I wish more shit was like that. That's why I love Jid, because I'm like, oh, this is fucking amazing. Something about, just like, I don't know where that's coming from. I guess sadly it's Eminem, but whatever it is, they're getting this chop thing and they're like, let's do it. Yeah. They do it their own way.
There's not much mainstream music I can stomach, but I can Kendrick Lamar is definitely better than most.
Yeah, you lose me. You lose me when you talk Kendrick Lamar. Yeah, I'm just not a fan of that at all.
What is it? What do you not like?
There's always one. I don't like that he's trying to be so righteous and so like into his people. And like I say, when I say he's more of like a Tupac, he's trying to make a movement out of nothing. And I feel like he doesn't have a lot to say for what he's been through. I don't know. I just don't see him as someone who's an underground hip hop artist or not even that.
I don't know.
But not that at all. But I mean, doesn't have, I don't know, that sense of.
Hey, man, good luck.
Shots fired. Yeah. Shots fired.
Shots fired.
There goes our chance of ever getting Kendrick on this fucking podcast.
Kendrick! No, discourse. I mean, you know, I think it's relative. I do think that, like, success is not. I'll just say this to what you said. Success is absolutely on the top 10 list of things I don't respect.
Definitely.
You can have it. It can ruin you. If you have it and it doesn't ruin you, that's the only positive effect of success on a creative, is that they have it and they're not walking with it like you owe them for it or they don't need to explain themselves to you.
It'll change you, though. Creative. It'll definitely change you. Like, you know, people we know, artists we know, it changes them when they get super successful. So.
Yeah, and then it goes away too, which is fun because you get this, you know, it's a moon phase, I'll say that much.
Mm-hmm. Comes in waves. Well, something that doesn't come in wave is your constant and your longevity in the hip-hop game, and we really thank you for everything you've done for the culture and for underground hip-hop and for you know, everybody out here. And we continue to support you and can't wait to hear some new music from you. And thank you so much for all your time tonight. We, you know, you very generous with your time on a Friday night. Didn't have to do that for us. And we thank you very
pleasure,
much
y'all. For that. Yeah, thank you. Thank you for appreciating it. Thank you for wearing the Alias shirt. Thank you guys for being grounded and like being someone I could talk to about this shit.
So for sure. Means a lot. We would love to talk to you again about this sometime. Talk some more on the podcast sometime.
Whatever, holler at your boy.
We definitely will. We look forward to hearing more from you. Everybody give it up for Dose One. Thank you, brother.
Hey, don't stop making music anytime soon. Love the Freestyle Fellowship shirt, bro. Yep.
Yeah, this sweatshirt is off the hook.
The hoodie.
Let's go.
All right, bro.
All right, guys.
Have a good rest of your night, brother.
Thank you for having me.
Hell yeah. Peace.
Peace, y'all.
All right. And there goes Meester Dose One. Hey.
Nice guy,
fucking
man.
Legend.
Nice guy. Fucking nice guy, bro.
Holy shit, dude.
A super nice guy.
I mean, I'm really talking about when I heard Anticon for the first time. It was the first time I was like, what the fuck? This is.
Yeah, it was weird.
I heard it before. I want to say I heard it before Atmosphere, but I might not have.
I might have heard
some Overcast before I heard before I heard Anticon. But when I heard that, I don't think because I've always said the first Slug song I heard was Body Pillow.
Yeah.
Yep.
I don't think that song made me think like, oh my god, this is so much different as the first time I heard a fucking Dose One.
Some of us.
You know what I mean? The first time I've heard that, I was like, whoa, what the fuck?
And we were extremely baked probably at that time. Blew me away.
But that's what we're talking about, making an impact and making a dent in the industry and fucking. For better or for worse, they did that shit. I'll tell you right now.
They changed everything.
And it's something that I'll never forget, you know, hearing
the Bottom of the Hill show. Was I there when we saw Idea?
He called up Dose One. He called him by...
Shout out to Dose One.
He called him by his government name, Adam Drucker.
Adam Drucker.
He just fucking called him on up, and they started fucking freestyling, man, back and forth. It was
I
so
don't know
sick.
Your memory's that good. My memory's not that good. I could be there, and I just don't remember.
Because Dose One, for one of my favorite... artists of all time, he's always blown me away. And then one of Idea's last shows, this was a
I just remember him screaming on the floor, laying on his back, yelling. Yeah, so that's what I remember.
I mean, there was a number
of,
you know, like that show was just wild in general, man. A lot of fucking.
Isn't it crazy to say, like, when people say, I wish I could have been there. I wish I could have been there. Yeah. We were there. That's kind of weird, you know?
We were there. It's humbling that we were a part of, you know, hip-hop history.
Maybe you didn't know that you were there at the time. It was going to be anything. But being there now and looking back, you're like, man, that was pretty crazy
was
that you could be there. Something
somewhat
big.
Niche. Yeah. It was different.
Very, very niche.
Special. Not everybody knew about it. And like Brandon was saying and Dose was saying,
a lot of people
community. It was like a community,
know
you know?
It, yeah.
It was a special little tight-knit community.
Very tight-knit.
That not many people were a part of.
The ciphers before the shows were always tight. Like,
for sure.
People would gather around. Freestyle with just the beats with the DJs playing on super fun. Super
I was
fun
watching
time.
A video of Sage Francis has been posting these short clips of him. He's in a cypher like during the show though.
They're all fucking
people rapping on stage and they're going in the crowd and it's just fucking great.
It's great because it's shitty quality. That's the shitty quality that I'm looking for, but, you know?
He's still killing it at the same time.
Can I just say that every time I kind of get down on doing the podcast every once in a while, I'm like, oh, man, that's a lot of work. What are we doing? What the fuck's going on? Mm-hmm. Then I talk to somebody that I grew up an idol, and it's so enjoyable, and I just am like, that was so fucking cool.
That
sparks the creative. And
it's
just like he was talking about when he would hear somebody that was dope or fucking sick creatively. It was like, I wanted to write there. I wanted to grab the pen and start fucking writing.
Steel sharpens steel. I mean, that alone for sure would spark you to want to do something more creative.
But just being able to talk to somebody like that we've looked up to, and he's just so cool as fuck.
Yeah,
and just
super
like
chill. Down to earth.
God damn it. That was Dose One that we just fucking
cheers
talked
to.
That.
To.
Dose
to that.
Motherfucking One. And
congratulations. Dude, hey, thank Dose you once man. Again. And that man is a really good... Not just a great artist, not just a great rapper, but he's
great
a great dude. And that's at Milkcrates Microphones. You can't stamp
it. We had a lot of milkheads writing in over here asking, what does Dose think of Harry Mack? And I didn't want to cut him off.
Man.
What does Dose think of Robert fucking Crusoe and Mush? And then a lot of people saying, a lot of people saying R.I.P. Bren. You know what I mean?
For sure.
You know, shout out to the milkheads.
Alias,
shout out. Shout out to the
Listen,
Milk.
We didn't want to get too much into the comments. Into I, even though we kind of did, Matt did with the Kendrick Lamar putting him down. We don't really want to get into like a position where somebody has to talk shit on people.
Yeah,
so
yeah,
I don't want to ask
not
those
a good
questions.
Look. Not a
good I'm
look.
Not fucking Dateline NBC. So if you want to see that interview, go somewhere else. We're just gonna sit here and have a cool conversation.
Let
about,
him talk. Let
and tell,
him tell.
I want
us,
him
yeah.
to tell us stories about mm-hmm. the history
yeah, yeah.
of hip hop and what
For
she
sure.
did. Because once again, this is some groundbreaking. Like
yeah.
A
sure.
point in hip hop that made a turn in the underground industry that also had an effect on the mainstream industry as well, because it really turned the curve
yeah.
for some artists in the
it
mainstream.
It lets you be
well.
You, kind of. It lets you kind of just release your creativity. I mean,
for sure.
A totally different style than what you're used
Once
to.
Once again, shout out Doseone. Thank you again.
Shout out to Doseone.
That's a legend right there.
Yeah,
and
for sure.
Us being from Northern California, that shit was heavily put onto us like
yeah for sure
oh this is Bay Area fucking
yeah,
underground
yeah.
hip-hop
yeah, yeah for sure
and it's like legends
mm-hmm. how did it even
it's
come
like
Hyro
mm-hmm. and it's like Anticon
yeah
and that was for me the
it?
Three
yeah, for sure me
how
too.
Did you find
me
it too. Though when I remember hearing some of us like,
yeah
how did that where did and that come who had the
one
album like, where did
broken
it come?
Into
it just
got to us.
I know how though that's the crazy thing like I don't know, it's just weird, you know?
Mask like hands and mini flies, man.
I would feel like it would just, when you look up weird things, it comes with it. You know what I mean? So,
yeah, it's just, I don't know. Somehow we got invited into that community, and thank God. And
thank God we did,
but
yes.
also talking to people like Doseone and doing interviews like this, it's keeping that community going.
Yeah.
It's
oh, yeah.
keeping the community
keeps going. The heartbeat alive.
Keeps it stronger. Yeah, I don't want it to die.
I know, because it is, like we've talked about, as people make more music... And music becomes, because he just talked about it. When you're an artist, you're just sponging. You're not stealing, but you're sponging in a bunch of styles around
yeah.
you to create, to develop
your
one
own.
Style.
Yeah, develop
right?
your own. Yeah, you're picking
now,
up.
Now, as music becomes more bad,
uh-huh.
as it progressively worsens, these new rappers are sponging all this trash. And they're just going to spew
just trash.
Out
they're
trash.
Just trash. Yeah,
right.
That's what happens. Yeah.
Isn't this what's happening? This is the evolution. I mean,
yeah.
I guess that's an interesting question we probably should have asked there.
Mm-hmm.
You know, hindsight's 2020. Well, if you want to come ask some fucking questions on my podcast, you come over here and ask some questions.
If steel sharpens steel, trash probably makes trash worse.
No, I'm just saying, you know, like he had a good point of like you do sponge in a bunch of people's styles. Like for me, I take a bunch off of a lot of people, like Idea
yeah.
and Eli and
for sure.
some fucking
for sure.
Sage and some Slug mm-hmm. and some of this.
For sure.
Like, like you're going to take that and mush your own style.
Yeah, I think that's okay.
And as... trash becomes around you, and if you absorb trash, if you're a sponge and you're absorbing dirty
yeah.
water, you're going to spew out dirty water.
Yeah, you're toxic. You only got toxic shit around you, so.
That's very Jeez. True. Very true.
This is not good. The future, that's what I'm saying, the future. But just like Joe Rogan has said on his podcast many times, is soft times... create hard men create soft times.
I think it's hard times create hard men, soft times create
no you fucked
something
it already
like that. Yeah, it's, but I know what you mean. Yeah,
okay, just like that. I think it's reciprocal. It's gonna cycle yeah. back, right? So
yeah.
like it's making trash music, but at some point it's gonna
I don't think that resides to music. I think it just resides to hard motherfuckers.
No, it's gonna recycle back. It's gonna make a full circle. Everything's reciprocal.
I think something like that. Soft times equal
full
hard
circle.
Men. Hard
circle.
Men make soft people or something like that because they didn't have to work so hard after they came and all that. I get
you
what
know
you're
exactly
saying. I know what you're
talking
saying.
About.
Put a beat on. Let's do our thing. You know,
freestyle?
Yeah, let's freestyle.
Okay. In light of having a freestyle legend in Doseone, because Sig so fucking great. One of Sig's always so good.
Great
at
interviewer.
Questions.
Great interviewer.
Sig's awesome. I fucking look up to this guy.
They call him Sig. Siggy the interviewer.
We do our homework.
Siggy views.
But Sig with great. the video of Doseone teaching. I saw that video years ago.
Yeah.
Probably like 6 years ago. I watched that video. Right. And
yeah.
Of him at the school, and he's fucking rapping, he's freestyling,
so
and the kids are fucking progressively getting better. You
yeah.
could tell. That in just one and just
a couple
like he
of
said,
them are
he's
shy.
Like one session, these kids got fucking better.
They're
yeah.
styling. They started
it,
styling. Like
a couple of
said.
Them are shy, don't even
it's
want
awesome.
To go. And he's like, all right, who's gonna go? And then all of a sudden, a little kid goes. He's like, all right, this is you know, that's tight.
That's
pretty
sick. That's
pretty
sick. You got
pick
some
balls.
Beats. What kind of beat you want to listen to?
Oh shit! Should I take it and hand it back?
Now, hey, now the choice is mine.
Let me ask you this though. Before we go,
yeah,
what are the top five beverages in the whole world?
That's what you want to know.
I just want to know real quick. What do you think?
Okay, time out. Are we talking? Specific brands?
No,
or are we talking
we're talking like a like just
beer,
like,
water.
Yes.
Okay.
Simple. Top five.
Water one.
Okay.
Number two, whiskey.
It's not on the list.
What do you mean it's not on the list?
It's just not there. Like, there's a list, you know what I mean?
I'm making my own list.
Oh, yeah, go for it. Okay.
Water is one.
Whiskey for sure.
Whiskey's two.
Been around since day one, I would say.
Beer is three.
Okay.
That makes me sound like a real booze bag, but it's just because I like those. I want them to be there, and I don't drink like sodas and stuff, so.
No soda for me.
Red Bull.
So what the hell? That's like, just crazy.
Red Bull's in there.
Red Bull, yeah. The original?
We're talking about like...
We're talking OGs.
This is... You know what I'm thinking in my head?
What?
We're saying top five. I'm thinking like you can only have five for the rest of your life.
The rest of your life. Shit. Yeah, rest of your lifetime shit. Yeah, for sure.
Red Bull's on there, bro. Okay. You know what I'm saying? Like, I gotta have a Red Bull.
I get it.
And then...
You drink coffee?
I don't drink coffee. That's why my Red Bull's there. There's my Red Bull.
You drink coffee?
I have to get through the day with coffee.
I don't
ever drink. That's how I start my day.
Crazy.
You know what?
That's how I start it. Wait.
You gotta have something to mix with the red with
orange juice.
With the whiskey.
Orange juice.
Whiskey. Gotta have a Coke.
Okay. Gotta have a Coke. Okay.
God damn it.
They say the top five is on like, that's like a
According to who? Who's
this is scientific shit. Like what they said. The top five drinks in the whole world are water, tea, coffee, orange juice, and beer. Those are the top because they're all water based.
That is a very good list. I'm not arguing that.
They say they're all water based is why, because water is in tea, water's in coffee, water's in orange juice if you make large gallons of it, and water is in beer. So they're saying it's like water based stuff, you know? So
Yeah.
How about you? What can't you live without?
Definitely coffee. Definitely water.
Mm. Water's my one.
Yeah, water's number one.
I drink so much water.
I love fruit punch, too.
Gotta have the water.
You make a real fruit punch or like a Hawaiian fruit punch?
I buy this certain one from the store.
You know what real fruit Hawaiian punch. Fruit punch is?
The one with the little fucking Indian.
Pog.
What is it?
Pog.
What's Pog?
Pog
is the...
The little tiny drink covers?
No. Pog is just a type of juice that is made in Hawaii.
Where did we used to get those
Pog
little juices?
It's pomegranate, orange, and guava.
Sounds great.
Fire.
Do you have any nonfiction beats?
Okay, you want nonfiction beats? That's what you want?
Where did you used to get those little juices when we were little? Little like, look like a milk carton, but it wasn't. It had a little silver thing you peeled off the top.
A juice box?
Yeah, no. It wasn't a juice box. Okay. It was like a little plastic carton. Like, it looked like an orange juice plastic carton, and you peel the silver off the top.
That's just straight sugar fucking juice.
Yeah, where did you used to get
those? It's like colored, each one different colors.
Yeah, where did we get those?
Orange, sugar, red, blue.
Water. That's soda water.
Right?
Sugar water.
That's what it is.
People would be like, I'm drinking water. This is like a Kool-Aid.
It was a Kool-Aid sugar. Remember what were those ones? Fruit Gushers? No. What was that?
Fruit Gushers?
I don't remember.
Fuck it. Give me one now.
This is the freestyle session. Yeah. Shout out to Doseone for a freestyle. Inspiration. Nonfiction. On the beat. And we waiting.
Yo, here we go.
And we wasted.
Don't scratch it. Yo. Scratch it, open up your pores, and just let it out. This shit is kinda different. On the mic, I'ma set it now. I said it once, I said it three times without a beginning. This shit is kinda different, but I'm never continue winning. I'm just losing real deepness on my thoughts. What I'm saying's kinda here and not. But if I have to say this shit, I'ma stand up real proud. I salute myself out, and I don't act like crowd. I ain't cowardish, I do this shit for the heavy. What I'm saying is that I'm here, and I'm kicking rhymes steady. I'm not steady arm, strength, strong, and what I'm saying's different without no sing-song. And I'm not ready to just sit back and let you have the beat. But if I have to, we're gonna do this together, and we can make defeat. Nah, defeat is only up in the air without rising. I'm doing this all day, microphones come alive and...
Come alive in. I'm still driving, thriving, trying to find my mind. Wonder why's in, wonder why is inside of your mind timeless. I don't give a fuck, all I wanna do is find this spineless cat that be walking around talking about some real freestyle. They don't understand nothing about the way we put it down underground. Never been found, it's now. I think you need to know I'm breaking ground with it. Every time I grab the mic, I spit some sick shit. Sometimes it might get a little bit twisted, or maybe I'm in it. Baby, it's a minute, crazy, isn't it? Or maybe it might be, it doesn't really matter. You don't even wanna fight me on the mic. We might be something that you've never seen. White flags in the air, everybody run the scene. I don't think you understand, I see everything. Everything for the things that you can't breathe, I'm breathing. Maybe I'm just seeing what it ain't for the evening. I lake it and leave it.
Woo! Shout out to Dose, shout out to Soul, shout out to the hot bitch and her bleached butthole. That's how I do it, I'm a cold ass dude. I don't give a fuck, man, I give you an attitude. Adjustment, yeah, an AA. This is me, a motherfucker representing all day. Yeah,
because I'm doing it, I'm hella fly. This is me, yeah? I'm the coolest fucking guy. Woo. You can't see me because I'm invisible. I'm sitting here, motherfucker, where am I gonna go? I don't know. I'm gonna sit here for a while. It's all good, man. I'll turn that frown into a smile. I'm underground. Woo. Where I like to rap, I'm sitting here chilling. I like to bust a cap, but not with the gun, with the pen. I'm sitting here, man. Shout out to MC Ren.
Yo, shout out to MC Ren, shooting out caps, but not the kind that come from Gats. I'm just open up to different type of cats. I do this all day, but I ain't kicking it back. I have to stand up real quick and look behind me. The shoulder's different, but you can't even find me. My mind is not leaving to a whole different conclusion. I'm not ready to make that way. It's an illusion. I guess I'm disappearing into the darkness.
Darkness?
Coming too hard, I guess I'm heartless.
Heartless?
I don't know if I'm coming that way, but you have to just spark this. I don't smoke no more, but people say it's nauseous. Narcissist of me to have to assist to see if I have to do this shit. I straight kick the beat. Woo. I sit down with ice in my cup. Why? I need the whiskey now, so motherfuckers stand up.
Yo, all I got is ice. All I got is ice. Baby, why do I only have this ice? I'm wondering why my eyes never really change. They only covered up because I wanna blame. Woo. Everything that I don't see, I'm pointing fingers at me. I don't think you understand why everybody's acting happy. They don't understand, they wanna at me. Even if I'm not their daddy, it doesn't really matter. I'm never really lacking, can't catch me on my back feet. I don't give a fuck, I'll see you in a back street. Got your girl in the back seat and everybody's happy. Everybody let me see you motherfucking clapping. Woo. I don't wanna see your hands together. I just wanna make sure that you know I'm forever. I mean, I might not be living for infinity, but I'm just here to make sure that I'm eating beats. Leave it to me. The energy stolen instantly. I always stay swollen. Fuck it now. It ain't about golden bears in my state. I don't care. It's not the swear. I like to tear the mic and maybe I can stay impaired. I bet you didn't know I was going nowhere, but here I am and it's always just so flare. I mean, that's fire. That's the flare that I throw into the sky, Skyler.
The flare, no Rick.
Shout out to Sky Skyler, motherfucker. I don't give a fuck. Shout out to Taylor Tyler.
Jesus.
I mean,
Taylor Tyler.
The wrong JTT. It was the fake JTT.
Searching for music.
JT Tyler.
JT Ty.
He's a knockoff. He's
okay,
what's fucking.
Okay. He's a fake brother.
He's his cousin.
He's got a show with Tim Saylor. Tim Saylor.
Oh, man. The pool man. He's the pool man.
The pool man. He's out there fixing your pool with some short shorts.
Yeah. The motherfucker's hanging out with, like, it's not Al. It's like Bob. He's hanging out with Bob. Motherfucker's
with Sal.
Stop. It's all good, though. Yeah.
Hanging out with
this
Sal.
Hip hop. What's up, Sal? How you doing? Pass me a tool. Okay. I need some shit for this pool. I need a net. Need some chlorine. I need to fucking put the shit so this water doesn't sink. I don't know what I'm saying. I barely know how to handle a pool. I'm really not that fucking cool. I used to be a tool man on a tool show. I used to have hot chicks. Used to call them my hoes. Used to have a guy named Al Borland. You see me? I'm fucking tongue twisted. Don't know what I'm saying. You just missed it. Motherfucker, look at me. I'm gonna straight diss it in your face, bitch. Ric Flair chop. This is how I'm doing it. Never gonna stop.
Never gonna stop. I guess it ain't gonna end. I don't swim in the deep end. I don't swim any close, I don't go underwater. I plug my nose and now I have to come straight at your daughter. I don't know if I'm saying this, but I'm saying it proper. Shit is kinda different, you can call me the doctor. I'm checking out for diagnosis, making sure you're not profit. If I have to grab this microphone, I come with halitosis. Bad breath, bad type of cess. What I'm saying is kinda different, get it off your chest. I'm straight ringing on this microphone. Motherfuckers think they're good, but they leave the mic alone. I see them somewhere else and when they're standing up, I take the microphone back and I say, you had enough. I say, sit down for a second and get stuck in the bleachers. I'll teach you in my class, cause guarantee I'm the teacher. I'm not ready to go, unless you're ready to exhale. What I'm saying's different, just pay me the mail. I mean, give me a tape so I can trade it. Shit is kinda different, everything that I say ain't really basic. I'm sitting up for some tights and some Asics. Pumas and Nikes, so people can't face it. I have to save the shit, but at night I wear bracelets. Cause I'm going to raves where your mother gets naked.
She on drugs.
Jesus.
Yo. She on drugs.
Doping.
Yo, and somebody likes paper, and some people just want to see you later. I like skyscrapers, especially the top of them. Whenever I see the bottom, I run again. Maybe my head is having fun again. Some of these cats, they be running the gun and then they don't understand why the fuck they not summon them. I don't give a fuck, cause I'm not a judge summing them. Tumming them, Maybe they don't understand that I'm loving them like the government now. They don't really know where they are, so we sound a little bit different whenever we kill around. We just wanna make sound that makes you go wow. They don't understand what a freestyle really isn't. Whenever I spit it different, it isn't the picture I'm painting, it's the way that it ends. And I don't give a fuck about the dent that you putting in. I just put in the work and make sure that it's thin like paper. Yeah, back to that again. And now I started and ended at the same place. Some of these cats don't understand the race, and some people understand why they name it fake. I ain't got that, talk about it. I ain't got shit, but you walk around with your head in the clouds like you all about it. I don't give a fuck, cause you know I'm sounding way too dope and way too clean. Wonder are we on the scene? It's wonder I ain't infamous, JS3, bitch. We just killing shit just for the infinite.
Yeah, for the infinite.
Yo, for the infinite.
Some people are running, some people are gunning. Me, I'm just sitting, drinking beer, stone cold stunning. That's how I'm doing it, motherfucker.
Yeah.
I'm sitting here chilling. You wanna step at me? You a cocksucker.
Okay, if you guys are really good, you can spit to a fucking Dose 1 beat.
Let's see it.
Oh, man. You can put on Dose 1 beat, you can put on a gel beat.
That fool's hard as a motherfucker.
It's gonna be a gel beat, right?
Classic, classic, classic.
I remember buying a gel album, all instrumental.
Yeah.
And rapping to it nonstop, trying to learn how to rap to it, and it was so fucking hard.
Shit.
I feel like
Gel has some pretty gnarly beats, too, though.
I feel like that idea of fucking Gandalf's beat machine was always being played.
Eli's
beat Gandalf's machine. Gandalf's beat machine? Oh, yeah, it was always being played.
It was called Gandalf's beat machine.
Yeah.
But
And he had a Gandalf beat machines 2 and 3 and 4. Yeah. He had a couple albums of it. Yeah. Does he still do those at all anymore?
He came out with one a number of years ago. Not lately, though. All
right, let's get real. Gel. Let's get weird.
Yeah.
Yo.
Shout out. I said,
I'm off the walls again.
Walls?
Shit is different, passing. What I'm saying is different. Everybody thinks they classics, but they ain't. They just outplay treasures. I do this all day, but I'm not heavy measured. I'm heavy metal, kicking down fences. I'm just sitting here without detention. I'm leaving class perfectly on time. You stay after school, Saturday school for mine. I'm not ready to rhyme unless I'm ready to kick this. Weed gets sparked up and I'm getting lifted. I'm not high enough to touch the stars, but I'm high enough to go behind your house and fuck your car. In the tailpipe, shit is different, right? I do this all day, people better listen. I have had enough of what you have to say. I do this on microphones without no delay, no decay, no tooth decay. What I'm saying's kinda different when I spit your way. Not silver grilled up, I got a perfect white shiny. Shit is kinda different, come right at your hiney. Microphones are on now, so don't even remind me. I'ma say peace now, so people come and find me.
Yo, you never get behind me.
Call him Jaime.
Yo, don't ever get behind me. You can find me trying to climb trees. I like the outside, you like the inside. I'm just trying to find a hive that I can find peace. Yeah, I love the way that we like these. I'm likely to be the cat that's so high that you can't see my eye. Please stay out of my way because I'm always on my mind, sweet. Never really find time to piece a piece. Maybe that's just the time in between. I wish I knew how to even construe the two. I don't understand where you are, who is your name, and your game we play. I'm from a spaceship and I got no time today. I wish that I couldn't really play this fade, but I'm stuck right here and I ain't got the space. I mean, really, could I cut a change? Or maybe we change the date and maybe that will make me a different age. I wish I knew how to turn the page. Just stay away. I like the way that I feel in my cave. I just paint on the walls, trying to make sure that you understand it all. I wish that it was that raw, but my jaw be dragging. I know that exactly why I keep sagging. My pants like it's 93. I just be rhyming. We all can find a tree. I just wanna climb these thoughts into infinity, all inside your spine. And wish that I could climb inside your mind. Everybody find a little bit of time, and maybe I could just travel down the spine. I like to rewind,
take it back then, I lose it now. I'm trying to back swim, I mean stroking through it all, holding it so close, my soul is just gonna be slammed through the wall, wall.
Through the
I'm
wall.
In awe, awe.
I'm just one man taking a stand,
yeah.
Because I don't give a shit about the fellow man. Motherfucker, I represent someone that can stand on his hands. I don't give a shit, motherfucker, that's how my mind expands to a further dimension. Not to mention, motherfucker, I'm sitting here stressing. Learned my lesson about three times. I'm gonna do shit differently in my rhymes. In my mind, I don't know what I'm thinking. My mind eye is fucking blinking. I'm sinking in my seat. I feel my feet. It's all good. I love my gel beat. Shout out to Dose One.
Shout out.
Shout out to all of them, son. Shout out to Alias.
Shout out to everybody out there.
Shout out to Soul.
Shout out to Passage. Shout out to Pedestrian.
Shout out to
DJ Mayonnaise, motherfucker.
You might be a slob. I'm a conspiracy theorist. Titanic was an inside job. I mean, they crashed into icebergs. The only ice I crashed into was afterwards. When I'm twisting my pipe. Shit is kinda different, I come you with a knife. And I twist that when I get deep in your thigh. Not like Nicolas Cage or Face Off, that's right. I'm not going that way, but I'm boat racing. Catch me on the floor, I'm fake facing. I mean I'm pig facing, take chasing, tape trading. People talk a lot about ice skating. Can't say that.
All I haven't done that in a while.
Yeah, it was fun.
That was fun.
Very fun.
Freestyle. Freestyle.
Friday.
Thank you guys for joining us. If you're still watching us on YouTube, thank you very much for joining us. Once again, thank you to our guest tonight, Dose One, the legendary Dose One.
Dose,
and only Dose One, the founder of Anticon, Dose One. He is the man.
Oh, yeah.
Really had a good time chatting it up with him. Look forward to chatting up with him again.
Yeah, fuck yeah.
On to some other stuff. You guys know this. I got something for you guys.
What you got?
I found out something weird, and I just scrolled across my YouTube, and I think this is going to trip you guys out a little bit.
Okay.
But I need you guys to stay with me.
All right.
Okay. So Adam Sandler. You know who Adam Sandler is.
Of course.
We love Adam Sandler.
Been watching a lot of Sandler flicks lately.
We love Sandler, right?
Longest Yard.
So a lot of Sandler's movies that he wrote, like Billy Madison.
You're saying they all go together? Is that where we're
Happy,
going?
Happy Gilmore. No.
Wedding Singer.
The love interest is VV. The names are Valley Victor, Victoria, fucking something V. It's like they're all VV.
What was Drew Barrymore's name in 21st Dates?
I don't know if she fits this one, but a lot of them are. Look up a lot of Adam Sandler and love interest being
names.
VV.
Yeah.
Then also a lot of his movies that he writes. His name is a five-letter word that ends in Y.
Bobby.
Billy.
Billy.
Sonny.
Sonny.
Yeah. Come something else.
Well, Veronica Vaughn.
What Veronica Vaughn.
Virginia Vanet or Vanette.
What is Vicky he in Valancourt? That's My Boy? What's his name in That's My Boy?
Valerie Varan.
I don't think he wrote that one. They're movies that he wrote.
Oh, okay, okay.
What's that all about?
I don't know.
The VV.
So and tell me
VV.
Again, Vicky Valancourt, what is it?
Is it because VV put together is a W? Mm-hmm. The W means something?
No. Okay, so this is what else I heard.
What is the W for?
Listen.
Two V's next to each other. I don't know.
I get it.
Somebody said this in a script. When a script is sent around, in the script before the a female gets a name, it's just W. And then when it gets a name before a specific name, it'll be split into two VVs for some reason.
Really?
It works out. Works out.
So that is a thing.
Okay, so pretty now easy. Here's another one, though. Mm-hmm. Five-letter word. V is the Roman numeral for five.
Yeah.
So V-I-C-K-Y? Okay.
No, Vicky, not the Vickies. But Bobbies are fives, right? Yeah. But V's are the Roman numeral for five, right?
Uh-huh.
And what is he in Big Daddy?
Get this, though. I guess not everyone. But
What's his name in Big Daddy?
What about Nikki?
I'm jumping down a rabbit.
Yeah, why? Nikki. But what is he in Big Daddy, though?
I don't know about
Sonny.
Sonny. Yeah, he's Sonny. Yeah.
Five-letter word.
And why? Yeah, I guess. Huh. Yeah, that's pretty crazy.
What's up with that?
And Vicky and all the VVs. What's up with all the VVs?
We found your secrets, Adam Sandler.
We're going to make a movie
We're
going to make
a
movie.
This? What is this?
I don't know. There is some articles written about it.
Did
he
sell his soul to get famous? You know how they say?
They do. I mean, it could happen.
And these are his movies, and he had to do these little things because they're like subconsciously trying to –
drill something into the masses?
Would you sell yours for the money?
What does that do?
At that point in time, would you sell yours for
$20 million?
I don't
know the end game, Sig, yeah. And I don't know who they are, but...
What's he gonna
but
do?
I like to know who I they, mean, what they are thinking. Thinking.
Is it not weird that
he
this
just happens
weird?
To make a huge fucking contract, multi-million deal with Netflix?
I love the hands. Like, the hands always sell me. When he gives me the hands and the fingers
all
and
of a sudden,
the, over
he's
the head
back.
Claps,
all of a sudden,
he's in.
He made a huge comeback, bro.
Yeah, of course he
kind of, sort of.
Murder Mystery.
How many movies does that man have?
It doesn't matter. Best movie he has is Uncut Gems. Uncut Gems, amazing.
That's okay. A great drama. A great drama.
Great drama.
But going back to that, like, it is weird that a lot of his movies for that sure. He wrote, he has VV, uh-huh. You know, VVs yeah. For. I didn't even think about it.
Yeah, I didn't think about
and
it.
And then the five letter with the Y's that hit me, and mm-hmm. I was like, this man is on to some
numbers.
Something
he's
weird.
In numbers. He's in the numbers. He's in the
something
fives. He's in the fives. In the fucking.
Give me
V's.
All the V's.
Veronica Vaughn. Virginia Vennett.
That's the girl on
Happy
the lawnmower? Gilmore.
Happy Gilmore.
Who's the girl on the lawnmower?
Vicky Valancourt.
Vicky Valancourt.
Vicky Valancourt. Mama
Valerie
Cita.
Varan. That's in Little Nicky.
Yeah. Okay, okay.
Violet Van Patten. Pixels. Violet Valentine. Hubie Halloween.
V-I-O-L-E-T. I think Violet's Halloween. Longer than six, right?
No, those aren't the five
oh,
letters.
His, oh,
these
okay.
Are the five
oh,
letters.
Okay, okay.
Yeah.
So his, like, name.
Well, what are their numbers?
Also, his names also end with a Y. Billy, Happy, Sonny, Bobby, Nicky,
and they're
Danny,
all five
Sandy,
letters.
Tommy.
Five letters. All five letters.
And all of them
Bobby,
are
Nicky,
five,
Ronnie, Tommy, Johnny.
All of them are five letters. They all didn't point that out, but all of them are five letters.
All of them. And V is
Hubie.
A,
Hubie.
Hubie.
Yeah, and then the Halloween movie, I Hubie.
And five
yeah.
Is a Roman, V is the Roman numeral for five. Is,
what do you think?
I think
Howard.
What
do you think he's into
Matt,
it?
That's what I'm asking
I think
weird.
Howard.
I'm asking you.
Howard and Uncut Gems, they call him Howie. Right.
H-O-W-I-E. That's yeah. Five. That's
but
five.
I-E is different. It's not Y.
Or H-O-W-Y.
But it's still ending
that's
in a
I-E.
Y sound.
Yeah.
I-E.
Oh, yeah. H-O-W-Y
okay. Maybe
is Howie.
E-Y. Maybe it's E-Y. I don't know.
E-Y would be too many. It's got to be H-O-W-Y.
Okay, okay,
H-O-W-Y.
Okay.
H-O-W-Y. Okay.
Well,
I said W is too
maybe
letters.
He don't care as long as it sounds like a Y. Like E.
Or I-E. I think H-O-W-I-E.
He wants that E sound at the end. That long E.
That E sound.
That long E.
Yeah.
He wants that long E.
I don't know, man.
What's the E mean? The E. See, the Y is really an E. What's
the
E?
Five?
Oh, maybe that's what
the
secret
is.
It's
always more number. I think
it's always been the E.
It's always been the Y.
Yeah.
This is quite the hole we're going down.
It was never the
this is the Saturn. What do they call it? The Sandler universe?
I don't know. I just, when it hit me, I was just like, when I seen it.
Sandlerverse.
I seen somebody say that, and then I dove into some comments. You know, I did a B-Sick thing where I started deep diving, and then I was like, this is insane. It really all, like, lines up. Why is this happening?
Yeah, yeah.
But I did find people on the Reddit thread that were throwing out in the scripts that get sent around, an unlabeled female is just W, and then once it gets VV. A name, it's turned into VV. They split
very
it for some reason.
It's probably easier for him to do that.
I don't understand
know.
Hollywood,
yeah,
man.
Writing, I don't know. I don't understand.
Or just being an asshole and being like, well, if they're VV, I was giving the VV name, you know? Fuck it.
Very cool, though. I think something you guys should look into. Definitely if you're watching,
hole.
Go ahead and look into that.
I think you should.
If you like
I think
to dive
you could
stuff.
Go down that hole more.
And VV could be anything. Victoria Valenzuela, fucking Veronica, fucking.
What's her name on
Velipo?
Veronica Far.
Yeah, anything you want, man. You'd be Vaughn. Von Vigfried.
What was your
Von Vigfried? Brandon Vry.
What would be the V that you would come up for your love interest? Give me
Von
a
Vigfried.
That's your love interest.
Von Vigfried.
It's a tranny.
She's a tranny. Her name is Von Vigfried.
Well, that's on par with the fucking with the field.
There you go.
Valencia. Valenzuela.
Yep, I like that. She's an Italian.
I would go with.
Von Vigfried.
Veronica is the one, right?
Yeah, for sure. Veronica
is
a hot name.
The one.
Yeah.
Super hot.
Yeah.
Veronica would be the one.
Or Vicky. Vicky's a hot name, too. I mean, it just depends, you know?
Vicky, but he used those ones.
Yeah,
he
so Veronica. I'd say Veronica.
Yeah, Veronica. I remember you were talking about the other Happy Madison world or universe is combining.
Happy Verse or yeah.
Was it
they're all combined like the so
Mr. Cheezel was it?
Yeah, or? Mr. Cheezel.
No, that was a lie though. That was a
they
lie.
They said that it's true. They
we
said
broke
it good. They
it.
Said
we
it could
broke
true.
It.
Well, I kind of looked it up though. Some people are saying the same shit.
No.
Like, there's a
research.
Okay.
And it was a bullshit.
It's all a scam. Huh?
So his what would it be though? It would be him going and being an ex hockey player that had his caddy as became a pro golfer as he set his caddy up to be a game. Designer because
at this fool that's a retired golfer that has a fucking
and now he after
they told him to ride the pony
all of his golf money all of his golf money turned around and made a game thing
time out Sig we can break this Happy Gilmore. Please. What's his
name?
Mr.
Cheezle. Mr. Cheezle would be his gamer tag.
What was his name?
Mr. Cheezle is not his gamer tag.
But it could be, though, if he's making a game thing, call Mr. Cheezle. I mean, people have gamer tags all the time that are just names.
He's not the same person. I'm just saying. It's not the same character.
We're pretending. We're pretending right now.
Okay.
And then he made the game thing, and now he gave him that, and then he Happy moves out. He's in New York now.
Okay. Here's also the other one that we debunked it, because we debunked it on this show. We debunked it with the bum's name, or sorry, the homeless or the displaced.
The bum's name. So he's a bum.
Man. The displaced man.
Lieutenant Dan.
The place man that was playing on Happy Gilmore.
He's like, hi. And he's home free.
Yes,
home
but free. He's not Lieutenant Dan, but home I free. Thought he was Lieutenant Dan.
The home
Dan.
Free man that was the caddy on Happy Gilmore, we looked at his name, and his name is different from the name of the guy, the gamer.
Hey, but what is Lieutenant Dan's name, and what is his name?
It's more believable that guy became a fucking limo driver in the 80s than he is fucking gamer in the fucking 2000s.
We were so fucked up that night.
Who the limo driver in the 80s is?
I mentally thought.
Who?
Wedding Crashers. Come on, guys. Keep up.
The wedding.
He's the bum.
Oh.
He's the driver in Wedding Crashers. Schneider? And then he's also the gamer in the 2000s. It's more believable that he went back in time than it is that he's in the 2000s.
So you're telling
me. Just keep up with my fucking sophisticated goat jokes.
So you're telling me that he isn't Lieutenant Dan, and he's not in Reservoir Dogs, and he's fucking not in Fargo, and he's not. Looks like the same fucking guy.
Steve Buscemi
is
we're
that
talking
guy.
About fucking
Steve Buscemi's crazy eyes.
Gary Sinise.
Yeah, Gary Sinise and Steve Buscemi are the same guy. Like, there's no go hand in hand. Same man.
Yeah. Well, maybe they play doubles of one.
I'm telling you, stunt doubles. We were fucked up in the old podcast, and you guys, I was like, dude, he is Lieutenant Dan.
I'm the one that was all. You were like, he said something about Steve Buscemi, and I was like, dude, that guy's a fucking legend. Like, think about it. He was Lieutenant Dan. You were like,
he was Lieutenant Dan.
Is this full stop for a second? He goes, wait a second.
I mean, he looks just like Lieutenant Dan.
What do you think about their?
We were on a roll that night.
No, dude.
Definitely on a roll that night.
Definitely.
What do you think about they're going to be making an 8 Mile TV show?
50 Cent got the okay from Eminem.
If 50's in on it.
50's making it.
M supposedly going to be behind the scenes giving him insight on Detroit.
No, I don't like it.
Oh, you know who's playing Eminem? Who's the fucking rapper?
MGK?
No, the other guy. Remember we watched him, the fake Eminem.
No, you're lying.
DGK? What's his name?
You are lying.
DGK?
No.
No, fucking yeah, Little Windex.
Little Windex is going to be playing Eminem.
Is this true?
This has got to be true.
I mean,
who else are you going to get to play
So
Eminem?
It's a bullshit.
Who else are you going to get?
Son of a bitch.
Who else are you going to get?
But I'm not going to let the truth get in the way of a good story. And if that is, hey,
it'd be good. It'd be a good idea. It'd be a good idea.
Yeah.
I mean, come on. Why not?
Digging ditches. My dick is in there while I'm doing dishes.
I mean, hey.
It's in there, man.
I'd be in.
Hey, for sure.
I'd probably be more into the show, I think, if Lil
if
Windex
he was in,
was
yeah, for sure. I could see it. Could you imagine him acting as Slim Shady the whole time, though?
I don't know.
No, I can see it.
I mean, well, he's so much already doing the character in these videos.
He wants to fight. I won't do that, right?
Why not just dive in completely?
I mean, might as well go full heads in as Eminem, you know?
Why not just dive in completely?
I don't know. Slip, fell, landed on my elbow.
I mean, shit.
All that's good. Put the basketball court up as the background. There we go. Now we're hooping. Hoop dreams, 50 baby.
50 Cent and Dr. Dre are reuniting for an album.
On the floor. Oh, it's all blurry.
It's the blurs. 50 Cent and Dr. Dre.
Dr. Dre are reuniting for an album.
What album did he do before? He made what's it called for him?
I don't know if they ever did an album together, but they've had like songs together
but
or whatever.
He didn't do anything in the club and shit like that, did he, on his first? None of that, right?
I don't know. Was Dre had to be somewhat involved. Aftermath, was he not making those beats?
I don't know.
Who produced for 50 Cent? Is that Get Rich or Die Trying?
No, is it? No, that's the second album. The first one is what's Many Men on? What is that on?
Get Rich or Die Trying.
Is it Get Rich or Die Trying?
Yeah,
I guess so, huh? With the shot with the glass broken behind him. Yeah, I guess.
I'm pretty sure. Yeah, Dr. Dre did produce it. So
he made the beats or he produced?
He produced.
Okay, there you go. So what beats he was behind the whole thing?
It looked like it.
Well, that's awesome that they're gonna get together and make another thing. I mean, best song on that album, Many Men.
Many men, many men.
I told you that was my my sports moment of the year last
great
year.
Great song.
Was Brian Robinson after getting shot coming out to 50 Cent? He comes. Can we watch the video?
Give it to me.
Let's watch the video.
Give it to me. Okay. I'm going to grab myself a drink. Get it.
All right. What you got on the list here for the video?
Okay. So Brian Robinson, rookie running back for the Washington Redskins. Before the season, he gets drafted. He has a great preseason. He's going to be the starting running back right before week one. He gets shot. He gets robbed and gets shot in the knee. And they think that his season's done, you know. They don't even know, you know.
Yeah.
Who knows what's even going to happen at first.
Yeah.
Dude makes a full recovery, comes back, comes to play week 10 or something like that, and comes out at home and in Washington for the Commanders, comes out of the tunnel, smoke blaring, and the DJ hits the song, and it's many men.
Okay.
Many, 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 They tried to kill that fool. Stole that fool's shit. Must be
on me. Who shot him? They ever catch the guys? Because you know he knows who did it. Probably. That's how the hood works. He knows who shot him, but he don't say nothing if he's a real.
Probably.
Von Wigfried with the big tits tonight.
That song's hard as fuck, bro.
Like, dude, for real, hard.
He's 20 years old, just got shot, coming out for the first time on the NFL.
The hardest thing is that people that shot him are watching it. They're like, motherfucker, dude.
That's true.
That's crazy to think, like, it's wild.
Oh, where's death? Dude, so sick.
Super hard. I give it that.
What's your Super Bowl pick of at this point? What do you think?
So
we made picks in the beginning of the year. I can't even remember what they were.
I said Steelers Packers.
I did say I said Tampa Bay Niners.
I said Steelers. No, that's no.
I said Dolphins Niners.
Dolphins
Niners. I said Tampa Bay would take Niners in like the playoffs. They wouldn't take us, but we'd take them on. At this point, who's in the Super Bowl? Who are the two teams?
My Super Bowl pick for the 2022 season. Now that we're in the playoffs, I'm going to go Chiefs-Vikings. Chiefs winning this.
Bills-Jaguars.
Chiefs-Vikings, huh?
You want to know my thoughts, Sig? And you could call me on Sunday.
Vikings?
And you could kick me in
they're
the...
They're a sham, bro.
You could kick me in the
they're
balls all you want.
They're a sham.
Okay, the Vikings could be a sham, but you kick me in the balls all you want.
Yeah.
I think the Niners lose to the Seahawks this weekend.
I know it's going to be a tough
I have a weird feeling about it. But you could call me when... Fucking Big Cock Brock. Yeah. When Big Cock Brock throws for 450 and four tutties,
bro, no.
You could McCaffrey, call me and kick me in the balls.
McCaffrey all day, baby. McCaffrey all day.
So you think
day.
They're going to lose?
What are you talking
you think
about?
They're going to lose, too? Nah.
I just have a weird feeling.
Watch McCaffrey go up the
middle. I have a weird feeling that this Pete
Watch
Carroll.
Debo. Watch Debo on the outside.
This Pete Carroll ran Geno Smith turnaround year. Seahawks are just on this run, and they're just like, there's something behind
if
it.
If they did, I'd be so
And then
angry.
Coming
I
to San Francisco.
Seahawks.
What do you got final score on that game?
Just give me a close game.
They're blowing them out. Close game.
Low scoring. Maybe, you know, like over under 38, I might take the over on that. I would probably say like 21-17 Seahawks.
That's a small little gap. Win by a fucking, you know, a little something-something over here. A little fucking field goal, you know, maybe. What do you got?
But I wouldn't be surprised. Listen to this.
Uh-huh.
I also wouldn't be surprised because this is probably how it should go.
Uh-huh.
Big Cock Brock throws 450 and four tutties, and they win 35-6.
You think so?
35-6? I mean, shit, that'd be nice. I don't know if it's going to be that much of a blowout, but that would be cool.
Yeah, I can see your guys' defense completely killing Geno Smith
and
shutting
monstrous.
That motherfucking
so what do you
whole thing down. But I could also see a few mistakes. Mm-hmm. Brock Purdy throws a fucking interception, strip sack fumble. You know, a kick return for a touchdown, some weird shit, and all of a sudden it's 21-17, and the Niners are just like, well, whatever, we did what we could with the seventh round Mr. Irrelevant quarterback. Look at, we shouldn't even be here, and we did this, and everyone's like, yeah, the Niners are cool, and Shanahan gets
a pass. Let Seahawks,
Shanahan gets a pass again.
I'm gonna let Seahawks get 10. They'll get 10 points on the board. Niners 21. 21-10, final score.
21-10.
Game tomorrow. 21-10.
Now you're feeling, huh?
Call me
Super
and
Bowl,
kick me in the nuts
Super
if
Bowl,
I'm wrong.
Chiefs 49ers rematch from a few years ago.
That's this Sunday,
and
huh?
Niners go over this time.
That Sunday?
With Big Cock Brock?
Yes.
Dude, I just don't know how he can.
And with Christian McCaffrey and Tebow.
I don't know how a rookie quarterback can go into a Super Bowl and actually do it.
I know.
With what he has alongside him.
It's what he has alongside him.
I understand that, but going against a team that
Ayuk.
A team you're talking about going Jennings. Against a Chiefs team that has been Kittle. There multiple times in the past 4 years.
You've checked.
Experience of the moment. Listen to how different Super Bowl is to just a regular NFL game.
I know. It's a lot of
pre-game
different
is
energy.
Fucking an hour long.
Yeah.
It's grueling. Halftime is an hour and a half.
I hate playoffs.
Hour and a half when you're there?
Their timeouts and commercial breaks are fucking way longer. It's way
harder. Is Super
Bowl
really an hour and a half when you're there?
Yeah.
Is it halftime. Really? That doesn't seem like it's that long.
Yeah. It takes a while. Yeah, that's the thing, too.
So everything's more slow paced.
There's
no momentum.
You gotta have Jay-Z perform.
I hate when they do that.
And all that
it's
shit.
All, the commercials breaks are way
NFL,
longer.
Dude, NFL in general is catered to TV time.
Oh, for sure.
At that point. You could tell that they try to stretch the time in between.
Well, you got commercials. People try to put commercials like, that they've never seen before. Everyone's always dying for what commercials being played.
It's interesting. Somewhat already, it's not like controlled, but kind of.
Who's playing this year,
elements,
there?
Elements, you know.
Who's playing the Super Bowl this year? Music.
Oh,
halftime show.
Rihanna.
Really?
Rihanna Riri. Only? Is it only Riri? Right.
And I heard Chris Brown's coming for a special.
Oh, he's coming. He's going to fuck up. They're going to do a smash hit. He's going to do a smash hit on her. Their classic smash hit.
But yeah, Riri is doing it.
Is this a fact or are you fucking around?
I'm 1,000%. You know me.
And so Chris Brown's coming out for the smash hit fucking remix they got.
Here we go.
Yeah, Rihanna.
Rihanna just released her.
Only Rihanna, though? There's no one else?
No.
Last year they had like 5-6 people out
Rihanna
there.
Post Malone.
I feel like every year there's always like 2 or 3 people at least. But this is only Rihanna.
They just
huh?
released a trailer for it.
Yeah, she did. She's teasing the people.
She look like shit now again, or is she back to looking cool? Because she just had her baby. She looking
I don't know.
Foul.
I think she's always was she? I don't know. I think people are always thinking she's.
I always
looking.
Thought
she's
she had
pretty.
A weird looking face, kind of. You know,
she's she does have a I guess unique face, but
yeah, yeah for
mischievous,
sure.
I think, or something.
What do you call it?
Mischievous.
Nah, she's not up to nothing. Bitch ain't up to nothing. But
she
having is. A weird looking face.
She's dark. She's into. Illuminati rituals.
I don't know. Seems like she's real.
She's drinking blood of virgins, sacrificing men.
Look at Sig. We're not showing the video.
It's been 2,100 days.
Okay.
Rihanna.
What do you mean?
We waited.
It's been over 6 years since.
For the YouTube.
Oh, for the use.
You can hear it though, guys. You can hear it.
She got a forehead on her. Never give up.
She's pretty.
It's all right, I guess, you know.
Weird ass hair.
She's got music. She's got music, man. Don't get me wrong.
You said she's got music? She's got music, man. She's got music.
She's got good hits. She's got some hits. You know what I mean? For sure.
You're a Rihanna fan.
My lady is, so I hear the song.
Really?
Did
you
know
say
I mean?
Rihanna?
Rihanna, excuse me.
Rihanna.
That's how much I'm not into.
This is Von Wickfried. This is Von Wickfried tonight in here.
Excuse me, guys. I didn't know you're such
Von
Rihanna fan.
Time out. I wasn't criticizing. I was asking if you were saying that because that was the right way. I don't know.
Well, you called her Riri like you fucking know her or some it's shit.
That's
like,
her boy. That's her boy.
You got all the girls in there.
That's
you guys
her boy.
Are listening
I know.
To
the girls are bumping.
Everyone knows it.
Everybody knows they call Riri.
What about Taylor Swift?
And my daughter and my lady.
What do you guys think about Taylor Swift?
Tay-Tay?
And do your daughter...
I don't know if they call her that.
Do your daughters like her at all?
I don't think my
daughter
listens
to
the country.
Apparently
people
love her. People
yeah, love her. It's not country music.
She's
is
huge.
Is it country?
She's huge.
It's pop.
No,
she's
just pop.
Country,
she would make
country
pop.
She's making country
pop. Have you
pop.
Ever heard that song, Shake It Off?
Yeah.
My daughter plays that over and over.
Yeah, my daughter likes that song too. I guess.
She plays that off the hook.
Shake it off. Yeah, that's true. That one is played a lot at the house.
People love Taylor Swift.
Good one.
Yeah. People love Taylor Swift. Bill Cosby is back. What? Bill Cosby
damn it.
Is
do
going
we
on tour.
He's going on tour, but they're suing him, so he might not go on tour before. They already hit
I
him
he was
again.
Blind and in jail.
He's out. He's charges have been dropped, apparently.
But they're re-suing him. Now they're re-suing him.
Well, okay,
there's other chicks trying to get him again.
I haven't
so
heard about that.
Let Bill live.
I'm not a Bill fan.
Don't let Bill live.
We could live, but I don't want to see him.
If they let OJ live, you got to let Bill live.
Have a Coke and a motherfucking smile.
Yeah.
Shut the fuck up.
Some of a Bill Cosby have a
Hey, shut the fuck up.
Yeah, exactly.
Jello.
Hey, I just feel like, what are you going to get from Bill? The guy's fucking 175 years old. What are you going to get from Bill?
Nothing.
You're gonna get fucking date raped and fucking raped like Kai.
He's already broke. From the audience already broke.
The audience will wake up. They're passed out. You're, pants down.
You don't think Bill's broke?
And date raped like Kai from Dogtown.
Oh my god. He's gonna he's gonna drop kick your ear off. One kick from the floor.
We
on
never
his back.
Finished that.
Yeah, let's
discussion.
Talk about Kai, the hatchet wielding.
So we're going back to this.
A little bit, real quick.
I remember seeing the video early on and watching it and thinking it was fake, and so I deep dived it, like thinking, oh my god. What is this? And who is this
Jimmy
guy? Because
Kimmel,
I thought
though.
He was so cool. He was so fucking cool.
At first, yeah, he seems like
I didn't even see the Jimmy Kimmel video. That's what's crazy, Matt. As soon as I deep dove, all I found was he killed. So it must have been a couple months later because it was he killed some fucking fool in New Jersey. And I was like, wait, he killed. Because when they said that he hit that fool with a hatchet, they never specified how he hit him or if the dude lived. We didn't. I didn't know shit. I thought he hit this fool with a hatchet and killed this fool.
They didn't even say
so
that
the whole time
court
we were thinking that he
court.
Just walked up
at
and
first
smashed
I thought
this
he was dead. Smash, smash, smash.
So we watched that video in 2013 thinking on YouTube thinking
he's
he
dead,
killed
dead,
somebody. And then when I did this little fucking dive, I found, oh, he killed some other fool. Oh, he was being raped. Whoa, this is weird. And then you fucking hear more reports. We start like reading like Reddit threads and shit about how he was lacing the joint that he gave to the fool that fucking drove the car into the guy, which was on the documentary.
I heard that, but he drove the. I don't remember that. What happened?
That's how it all starts.
At one point, he's telling a story to some guys
I
laced
right.
the joint,
and
then
he crashed, and
then
he got
dude.
Out, and then homie got mad, and then he smashed him.
He's like, then I told him, I said, you won't be able to drive through that.
Yeah,
man.
Something like that. I do remember
so
that.
So he gives this guy a joint, and he says that the guy can't handle his shit. And the guy, who's this 6'4", 280-pound, like, big motherfucker.
Yeah, big white racist guy.
Says, I'm fucking Jesus Christ, and I'm going to rid all the world of
black
people.
Mm-hmm.
Jesus. Sees a group of PG&E workers.
Yeah, one black dude.
And drives his car straight into this and pins this. This man between two cars.
Yeah, I remember.
And then he's yelling that I'm Jesus Christ, I'm Jesus Christ. And Kai's just like, what the fuck? And then the dude, some girl comes up to try to help, and the guy gets out of the car and attacks the girl.
Yeah, that's
and that's
right,
when
that's
Kai
right.
gets out, like takes his axe,
give
and
him
goes,
the smash, smash,
smash,
smash,
smash, smash. Yeah. And at that point, we thought that he had.
He's a hero.
We love this guy, undeniable hero and charisma, and
standing
what
citizen.
A promo he fucking just cut. Like
good Samaritan,
you know me about like I love showmanship and the promo that he cuts about like.
And then he
has
a message.
He
has a message.
He goes,
first,
that's how he starts.
First,
first thing he goes,
he
has a message, which hit me, and I was like, I love this.
Yeah.
Then he says, as somewhere in between, he goes. They go, you're like a hero. He's like, well, if somebody just wants to give me like a 6-foot board, I'd like to try out Mavericks. And that shit,
boss,
I was just like,
perfect.
What a boss.
What a smart move. Smart
I was
move.
Like, this fool will die at Mavericks.
Yeah.
You know this fool can't surf Mavericks.
Yeah.
Come to find out, though, when I watched a YouTube, I'm pretty sure that the dude from Netflix that made this documentary had watched this YouTube video that I watched a while ago, a couple years, maybe 4 years ago, three years ago. I watched a YouTube video that was about Kai again because I saw it come up and I was like, I remember this one. I watched it because a lot of that shit was in the
Netflix movie,
which the Netflix one was done way better. It was fucking tremendously done. I really, Netflix always does good shit. They have good people working for them, but I'm pretty sure a lot of the shit came from that YouTube video. They probably saw that. Somebody probably saw that and was like, oh, this needs to be a fucking Netflix.
And then he goes and kills that lawyer
so
or whatever he is.
That was the wild
thing.
We were like, so was
all of a sudden
he,
he's in New Jersey.
Is that the one where he was Nate raped?
Yeah, apparently. Yeah. He wakes up and he was like,
and he said he was on top of him
mouth.
And then he fucking kicked him
but
one kick,
no,
blew
no,
his
no,
ear
no,
off.
No. The metallic taste in his mouth wakes up, then gets drove to the bus stop.
Yeah, what's
gets
it,
on a
hugs
bus,
him and then hugs him or something?
Gives him a hug, says goodbye, gets on a bus, can't get a ride because his friends doesn't show up, so calls the dude back and goes back to his house and then kills him.
Why does he give him a hug, for one?
Because he says goodbye.
He got paid for sex.
Yeah, they did the sex.
Get
sex.
Real.
He did the sex.
You
come
know
on,
really
Von Wigfried.
So
you know what it's like.
So you don't think he got raped or
no,
whatever?
No, Kai got paid for sex, and then
he
Kai,
realized that
Kai,
he didn't
you don't
like
remember
it.
What Kai, no, Kai went on the thing and was like, on Twitter and put out a tweet about is
killing a pedophile fucking vigilante justice, is it right or is it wrong?
Yeah,
yes or
and
no?
And everybody said
da,
yeah.
Da, 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 and all this weird shit. And then I think he just was like, I'm just going to go on a mission to kill, because he had got raped once before.
Uh-huh.
Before, remember he had talked about...
Do you have that thing up still? I don't know. Sorry.
How are you going to let him... How are you going to let somebody rape you?
No, he said he got raped before when he told... when he talked about... when he was talking to the dude in Stockton, he was talking about how he had, was held down and raped when he was 17, blah, when he first got on the streets, right?
Yeah, yeah.
And so
stories.
He had
how
some,
bad would that suck?
He had something in his mind about wanting to kill pedophiles.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
He was like a vigilante.
Which good for him, but he wanted to go on vigilante, which
anti-hero.
I think that he took money for sex from this guy to set him up to be like, all right, yeah, you are a fucking pedophile. You fucking just fucking...
Fucked my butthole.
He's fucked my
butthole. You fucked my butthole.
Now I'm going to kill you.
Now you're dead.
And he gives him a hug, and then he leaves, and he's like, fuck that. I'm going to go back and do
Why
it.
Why would you let
and
him fuck your butthole? You should have just killed him right when he gave you the money and said, I'm going to fuck your butthole.
He likes the money and the sex.
I think he likes the butthole. Have you seen him lately? He's kind of yoked up in jail now.
He's flexing no longer.
You seen him? He's like that.
Oh, well, yeah, he did look like he's working out.
He's working out. He's getting good size. He's got a fight. He's got a fight for his butthole now. They're not going to take
he's
it from
giving
him.
It up. God. He's just giving
for
it
free.
Up.
No, he's just getting it for free.
Don't lie.
Definitely an interesting documentary. It went somewhere I didn't think it was going.
You know what they're telling him when they're fucking him? Whack, whack,
so
whack.
I knew where everything was going, but I liked the way that they did it. I still, even knowing... all the spoilers and everything about it, watching it, because after you said it, I was like, I'm going to watch it for sure, because I want to talk about it with you guys.
Could you imagine
it's and a after watching
deal?
It, I was like, this is so much better than the one that I watched, and then I even learned a bunch of new stuff about how he was a really good musician, and
he
actually was a good surfer. Like, I remember seeing videos of him surfing and falling over.
Well, he sucked at skateboarding, so that's why.
I saw that, and I was like, this guy's not a surfer. He's going to go ride Mavericks?
But you could be good at surfing and suck at skateboarding, though. I mean, it's happening. I mean, because you could be good at snowboarding and not be that good at skateboarding. No. So, I mean, come on.
Yeah, you got to be decent at both. But what a good story. Well put together.
How did the reporter get, like, he's like a baller all of a sudden. Like, he interviewed Kai, and then his life changed.
Well,
all of a sudden, he's making money.
Well, because,
he's creating YouTube videos.
Because he was a sports. He was a sports.
He lost weight. He's dressing nicer.
He
got a little haircut.
He was a sports analyst, though, and
well,
he never got a chance to have
up.
A breaking story, though. Okay.
Well,
but that's
also, that was when
it.
He first started, right? Yeah. So he's just getting into it. Now he, even if he didn't go famous from that, he still has had years in it, so he's made more money.
But not
he's
only that,
established
though,
himself.
You
and
have
now
to, you really
he's
stepped
in a
up his game
spot.
Since
he's
that.
In a better spot.
You also have to imagine if you had a breakthrough one-time hit wonder story on you, people are going to want you to cover more
For sure.
shit. That's more true. And more shit. And more and more shit. And he probably did decent on all the other shit he did, but nothing like Kai's story, you know? So
the one discrepancy was, did they put it on the...
Such a professional discrepancy.
Did they... Did they put it on his channel? Because he goes, I put it on my YouTube channel, and then the video
overnight.
Then
said,
the video guy said, "We put it on my channel."
I got like
and
20
it blew
views.
Up on my channel.
20 views.
Whose channel?
Pretty good.
And then all of a sudden, it had
500,000.
But then the reporter goes, "We put it on my channel, and it got all blown up." But they both were saying two different things.
Isn't it weird though that they were like, "We're going to give him a deal with the Kardashians"? Like, what kind of show would he have had? You know,
he was like the weirdest guy.
Remember
really?
The first all. That wouldn't have worked. I just wanted him to be on Kimmel, and that was hard enough.
Yeah, I don't think that show would have worked too good. I mean, he would have been arrested all the time. You would have shown him pissing on something.
He
would have caught
he
his
was
ass.
Always
awesome
pissing
was
on
that
something.
Way to piss on Jimmy Kimmel.
Yeah, oh and he was actually kind of reminded me of Pauly Shore. He's kind of Pauly Shore-ish in a way. You know what I mean? Like, doesn't care.
Even the hair.
Like,
even the hair.
Like, cruising with the fucking cheetahs. Oh, he's in there. I mean, I could see it.
Juicing the
Biodome just turned 27.
I seen that.
The other day or whatever.
I was watching his movie.
Is that Baldwin the only... Is that the only movie that Baldwin
did? No, but that's his biggest fucking...
He's been in a few things.
I mean,
what else?
Is that Matt Baldwin?
Steven.
That's Steven, okay.
Okay, but the best... I mean...
The best
I'm
Baldwin's the one that shot people.
I'm not gay. No, that's the best looking Baldwin is the Baldwin in Backdraft.
Which one's that one?
And that fool should have been better. He should have been the biggest.
Well, if you're not a good actor, it doesn't matter.
Is that the Christian one or...
I don't know, man, but the
backdraft
Baldwin is a fucking, he's a top five Baldwin.
So Alec Baldwin, you think he's in top five after shooting people and he's fucking insane?
Alec's still top, he's
Alec,
a one.
They say
he's
Alec shot fucking.
William Baldwin.
Is the backdraft Baldwin?
Let's see him.
Yeah.
Thank you.
They said that Alec actually shot Brandon Lee, too. Crow? He shot the crow?
Oh.
All right, let me see him. Let's see this guy.
Backdraft Baldwin is the best Baldwin.
That's not... He looks just like... Dude, that fool looks like a... he looks like Joe. Old. He looks like Joe fucking Gatto.
Wait a second.
That's
you're showing me old one? I want Backdraft.
Okay.
I want 1993.
Hey, screen that
William
shit. You
Baldwin.
Know how to screen that.
I will. Okay. William Baldwin.
Give me Backdraft Baldwin.
Backdraft Baldwin.
Just type in Backdraft Baldwin.
Okay. Remember when Kevin used to do this? Yes. Backdraft Baldwin. No, it's got to be capitalized. Rewind it. It's got to be a capital.
He used to type it in the top T-bar. Like, just put it in
just
Google.
Put it in Google, man.
There he is.
Look at this guy.
I mean, he's a handsome
look
guy.
At this
don't get
guy,
me wrong.
Man.
I mean, he's not a bad looking guy. Yes, I mean, if that's, what, if that's what you're into, you know.
hold on.
Look at that one. Look at this
fucking
guy.
Vicky Von Siegfried
lady.
That's
a top fucking five Baldwin right there you're looking at. That's a good Baldwin.
That's
stop being so fucking
William
harsh
Baldwin,
on the Baldwins.
William
that's,
Baldwin?
That's Von Siegfried's lady.
Dude,
right
William
there.
Baldwin is
Chicago.
He's a top three Baldwin.
Show me the main character in this
give
movie.
Give me your top three Baldwins
give
right now.
Give me the main character. Alec.
He's number two. Alec, William.
Wait,
Matt, Alec, Matt Baldwin,
Alec William. No, that's fucking Kurt, dog.
Old Kurt. I just want to see who the main guy is again. I've been a while since I've seen this
Backdraft
movie.
Main. Backdraft who is the main actor?
It's wanna, Kurt. It's Kurt. Because remember they told him to check the door. He checked the door. The door's on fire. Blur you away. Get the backdraft. I remember the whole fucking things being about the door. The door being heated. The steam. The smoke could pull you in. Blow you away.
Yeah, that was classic, man. Fucking
dude, are you fucking kidding me? Oh, wrench your heart. You go. I go.
What's your favorite Kurt Russell movie?
Ooh.
The Thing is hard,
Escape
dude.
Escape from Anywhere.
The Thing is great.
Oh, very
Escape
good.
From
very
New
good.
York.
Yep.
Escape
from
LA.
LA.
Yes,
yeah.
Yes.
I
like
name?
The Thing, though.
Snake Plissken?
Snake Plissken. No, Snake Blisken.
Blisken.
It was Blisken?
Give me all his action movies. Blisken. He's been in some badass corny action movies that were amazing. Give me those.
There was one where his wife got kidnapped at a truck stop.
At a truck stop. Yeah, what was
that
called? And he searched for her the whole time. And he's a dude, he's killer.
Finds her in like a barn or some shit.
Yes.
Such a good
Is that where they pull homie apart with the trucks?
I don't remember, but
they tie him up from bumper to bumper, hand to feet, and they just yank him apart.
The Rustock is in a real...
Oh,
he's Santa Claus, too.
Death Proof is amazing. When
he's
Santa
Claus.
Stuntman Steve or some Stuntman Joe or something.
Captain Ron.
No, Stuntman Mike.
Captain Ron. Thank you, Captain Ron.
I still love that movie.
I still do love that. I watch it all the time. I have it on Amazon.
I need to buy that shit.
I bought it on Amazon
Prime. You can't find it anywhere.
Amazon Prime.
Yeah, you have to buy it. You have to buy it.
In 79. It's only like $8.
I know. You always have
to. Look at that fool as an Indian. In 76, he was Indian. Damn. Right there, the
bro,
black and white.
Slow down. We're trying to find this movie.
Sorry,
go
sorry,
up.
Sorry.
The Thing, man.
Big Trouble in Little China was
it's right after.
Oh, Killer.
Tombstone.
Soldier. No,
Soldier.
No, stop.
Poseidon. He was in Poseidon.
Entry. Stargate. Stargate's fucking class.
He's in Poseidon.
He's in some fucking.
He's in the Hateful Eight. He's in the Hateful Eight.
Fast and Furious 7.
He's Santa Claus now. He's Santa Claus now, bro.
Yeah, he's a sick bastard now.
Wait a second. We still don't see that movie where his wife's at a truck stop.
Which one is that?
It's I'll know it when you see it. Keep going. It's Breakdown. It's Breakdown. It's right there. Far left. Far left.
Where?
Far left.
Yeah.
Yep. That's it. Yep. He's holding
I just watched that recently.
Good movie. Good fucking movie.
You know, also though, how does the wife get kidnapped so easily?
What is he in Forrest Gump?
He's like just not paying attention.
What is he in Forrest Gump?
I don't know.
He's on
Kurt
there for Forrest Gump.
The fucker's a legend.
What is he? That's Forrest Gump in 4K. Is that a different movie?
He's probably a producer. Probably
that's
a producer.
What it said. Forrest Gump 4K. Is that different?
Damn, he plays an integral role.
He's
in Forrest Gump? You're lying.
No, he's a producer.
Dude, he's Lieutenant Dan.
Dude, don't you get me started. I will believe it.
Nah. That will turn our world around right now.
I can't find them right
Forrest
now.
Forrest Gump,
cast
Kurt Russell.
That might have been fake.
I think that might have been a fake
maybe
one.
Maybe he was a producer or something weird.
I hope not.
I don't know. Man.
Oh, I think he plays.
But definitely Gary Sinise was.
Here he is. He's in Forrest Gump. Inside the scene where he's playing Elvis. It's all bullshit.
Stop.
He was up there for that, but he's not in it, I don't
think.
Another
fake. Another fake.
It's a fake. It's a fake.
Gary, but Kurt Russell is a top five 90s.
Oh, they said that
actor.
Kurt Russell was supposed
he's like,
to
you
play
know,
Forrest Gump. That's
Kurt
what
Russell
it is.
Was
supposed to be
really?
Forrest Gump. Yeah,
instead of Tom Hanks.
Instead
would,
of Tom.
Would you like to see
bad
Kurt
move,
Russell?
Bad move.
Bad
guess
move.
What? Guess
Tom's
what?
One of my favorites because of that.
Tom is a top
Black
three Tom.
Like a box
that
of
Tom,
chocolates.
Tom Hanks is top three Tom. Give me top three Tom.
Top three Tom. Tom Cruise, Tom Hanks, and fucking Tom fucking.
Who's the third Tom?
Tom Sawyer.
Tom.
Who's the third Tom?
Tom Sawyer. Tom Sawyer.
It's a really strong top three.
Tom Bergeron. Tom Bergeron.
Top two Toms for sure. Tom Cruise, Tom Hanks.
Yeah, for sure. Who's the other Tom, though?
Tom Cruise is one.
I can't think of another Tom. Cat. Tom and Jerry.
Tom Hanks. Tom Clancy.
Tom Clancy.
Oh, there's no man. Other
Toms. Tom Jerry.
Who's my third Tom?
Yeah, who's your third Tom?
Oh, man.
I don't know. I don't know any other third Tom.
I don't know.
Yeah. Dang it.
Is there any other
Tom? Tom Jones?
Tom
Jones would be a singer.
Tommy Lee Jones.
Like I said, Tommy Lee Jones, the only guy let fuck my mom. Tommy Lee Jones, a nice
he's,
guy.
He's pretty good. He's pretty good.
He's a real nice
guy. I'd come home and I would see her with Tom Jones. I'd be like, I understand.
I heard he's Tommy a dirty.
He's a real nice guy.
Hey, that's
a dirty
fine.
Man behind the closed he's door.
Nice guy, though. Nice guy in the face. Nice guy in the face.
He has a sex swing.
Hey, that's fine with me. Let him have it. I don't know about that stuff, but Tom's a nice guy. Good Christmas presents. Always gives the booze.
Hey, was Tom from MySpace?
Oh yeah, Tom
from MySpace.
Yeah, what's his last name?
Tom 3 Tom.
What's his last name?
It doesn't matter.
We don't know. It was just
Tom
3
Toms.
Tom MySpace.
Tom from MySpace.
Okay.
Yeah. Tom Hanks.
You'd always
Tom Cruise. Tom Hanks. Tom from MySpace.
Tom Cruise. Tom Hanks.
Tom from MySpace.
And Tommy Lee Jones.
Tom Anderson.
Tommy.
Tom from
yeah. Tom and Pamela Anderson.
Tom from MySpace.
Man, it's amazing that. You know, that's iconic right there.
Tommy Boy? You got Tommy Boy in there.
MySpace Tom, you know?
MySpace Tom holds it down, bro.
That picture.
He was a
you're like a nice guy, huh?
That picture.
Everybody,
nice guy.
He was everybody's friend.
Yeah, he came
instantly,
with it.
He was stalking you instantly.
You would think that that guy would try to fucking spike your drink at a college party. Yeah, like he would try to fuck you when you're not knowing it.
Oh, college
party creep.
So many
drinks. Yeah, he looks like a drink
spiker. He probably invented one of those. Oh, sure. One of the Spanish flies.
Hey, do you want a
version?
He looks like a Beastie Boy. One of the ones they canceled.
Bro, the early days. You know those early days when like Blue Dolphin Ecstasy was still around.
Yep, yep. But he was taking the Nike signs.
Triples.
He was taking Nike signs.
Oh, yeah. The days.
You got a song?
You guys got a song, Rick?
Yeah, I got a song.
Pick. I go.
I'm the motherfucker.
I never go first. I'm going.
Go ahead. Anything you want to.
No, we're not.
Anything you want.
We're doing Dose 1.
Yeah, I don't know. Anything you want from that.
Please, play any Dose. But anything. You can play anything.
Anything.
Play
that's
themselves.
What I mean.
You can play
Deep Puddle Dynamics. Yes, you can play a string along. Anything you
play
you want.
Fucking
no, I'm playing
Alpha.
Something. I listened to this album earlier today. G is for Job. It's Dose One's album he put out in 2020.
I like the pair of
barefoot. So it's recently, a very recent. So it's got a really recent Dose One feel to it, but still a very classic
just
song.
Do it.
So
just do it, baby.
It
just do it.
It slumps. Shout out Dose One. Thank you very much for coming on. This is Dose One off of G is for Job, Big Bang.
Woo!
Won't get a bone. We don't ugly legal and crooked flags. Our reasoning is
Hell yeah. He's like flexing all the styles almost.
Very nice.
What the hell was that? Big
Bang Clock. Von Victory. Von Victory blowing out Vogue.
That shit's hard, bro.
That's Dose One with Big Bank. Pretty off sick. Of G is for Job. It just came out in 2020. Some newer stuff. Look at the cover art. Hell yeah. Just very simple. Yeah, we'll show. We could play.
Throw it up. Throw it up.
He gives us the A-OK to play
throw
this.
Throw it up. Throw
in case
it
you're
up.
Wondering, he gave us all the A-OK.
Of course. Of course. We have now become
so you know Dose did the
this is the new shit you were talking G is for Job, right?
G is for Job. So very, very simple, but very very clean. It's just so clean. The clocks.
I like the shark. It's a hammerhead. Kind of hammerhead shark. Would that be?
Yeah, it's like a shark.
With the G.
A shark, and then the other thing's like a bomb, like the bomber teeth they put on the side of a bomb.
Oh, fuck. Yeah.
There's also a...
They got a skeleton or a skull in the back. Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
The gears.
The Dose One is super clean up top. Just boom.
Legit, bro.
And I like that the name isn't up front. Like, the name of the album isn't like, G is for Job right here. It's just a G right here.
I heard him talking about
J,
it.
You know what I mean? Yeah. Like, what are we talking about here?
It reminds me of the thing where the snake eats its tail, the tattoo.
Yeah.
It reminds me of the shark eating itself. Yeah.
I heard him talking about it. He said it's a spinoff of G is for Gangsta.
Oh, that's
okay.
Cool.
Okay. Because he has another album called G is for...
Deep. Yeah. G is for Deep.
It should have one.
There's a couple. I think he has a couple.
I think
of
there's
them.
Those two, maybe.
V is for Wigfried.
I heard him talking about it in like another interview.
So I heard him talk, or maybe I heard somebody else talk about this album specifically.
What did they say about it?
And it just made me want to listen. They're just like, it was the best thing I heard in 2020, something like that. And I was like, maybe I just need to listen
to
something
new. It
just
seems so
new.
Wild.
I
want
to
listen to it, and it just seems so hard to grasp. I'm not saying there's nothing wrong with that, but it just it's wild.
Well, that's
the best part about
it.
That's
what a lot of people feel about. Like, he's almost, for one, rapping like in a cryptic like style. Like, you have to try to
You got to discriminate,
break
it
down.
What do they call that? Decipher. You got to decipher that.
But you don't have to though. You just listen to it as a whole.
Listen to it. Let's do it today.
You can listen to it as a whole.
Yeah, either way, it doesn't matter.
Dive into
it. It was hard to grasp. It was just hard to grasp for me.
Yeah,
it was very good though. Very good.
Either way, as the flow, the beats. Give me.
So I was working and I was just listening to it as a whole project, and it was just good. It's just good music, and I kept hearing stuff. I was like, ooh. Ooh, you know, like that stuff, the nostalgia.
Keep it moving, keep it moving.
Drag that shit out of you, and you're like, okay, I like that. But specifically, I heard that song, really liked it. So ahead, Sig.
Give me Derby of Days by Dose One. It's produced by Alias, and this is off of the album that Dose was talking about. Came out the same year that Alias passed away. So
R.I.P.
Very tragic.
R.I.P.
R.I.P. to Alias. Bad timing. But they put together a good album.
R.I.P.
Alias produced the whole
R.I.P. Derby of Days. R.I.P. Bren, man.
Huh?
Derby of Days?
Yeah.
R.I.P. to the one and only legendary. Somebody that also on Anticon, I can say this right here, that like as much as the Soul and Dose and the other rappers and producers were so different, something very comforting and very... nice about Anticon was Alias being in there, because he kind of brought he actually had rhyming patterns and like stuff that was more traditional, and you'd be like, oh, okay, that's more comforting. You know, it makes you feel more at home, as did when you heard like Deep Puddle stuff, and you heard Slug on it was more traditional. Nothing wrong because I really love, obviously being an idea fan, I really love the untraditional. So I really like Dose One, and I really like Soul shit.
Yeah.
But also when you buy an album, it's like, okay, this is cool. But then you hear like an Alias and you're like, oh, all right,
that's awesome.
Something that I'm used to there. Right? Something that, okay, that makes me feel good. Okay, oh, now I'm back to, you know what it is? It's like when you're going into a mine, right? And you're like mining, and you're like, oh, I'm fucking digging and sweating.
Little diamond.
I'm breaking my hands. And then all of a sudden, oh, I got a diamond. Cool. That's tight. Just keep digging. Let's keep digging.
Big diamond.
We're sweating. We're bleeding. We're finding something else. Oh, I like that. That feels nice.
It's
right
golf.
There.
It's like
Let's
golf.
Put that in.
It's like golf.
And then Alias would stop rapping after a pretty short period of, you know, just putting out raps and then just only focusing on producing. And everybody still wanted him to rap, and he rarely would.
What was this solo song that was on the music for Advancement of Mankind? It was so fucking good, dude. And that's what I'm talking about. Listening to that album, you like listen to it, you're like, good, good, good. I like this. Tight. Oh, fuck. Alias. Yeah.
What was the name of the song? That. You got it? That.
You know what I'm talking about.
Divine Disappointment.
Divine Disappointment. Thank you.
Oh, very nice.
So fucking good.
Yeah, it's crazy. Yeah, it's a crazy track.
Okay, back to this. Dose 1.
Dose 1.
Derby of Days.
Produced by Alias.
There we go. All right, baby. Anticon is also the ones that you, when people are like, what kind of music you listen to? Oh, like underground hip hop, like, I don't know, like Sage Francis, Anticon. Yeah. You know, weird shit. Right?
Yep.
It was a name drop. It was a good name drop. Who the fuck is he? You know this man says me. Keep it tearing when I'm in my face. Battle shadow brothers clear my place. Why am I beside the things I hate? Shredding my regret because I already ate. Creature I shouldn't have, good and bad. Know me like the back of my hand. It sounds like Sugar Free a little bit.
So good.
A little bit, huh?
Yeah, yeah.
A little Sugar Free in there. The opposite of quit. Don't let what you've been through forget you. What you've been through forget you. Now that I hear it, I can't unhear the Sugar Free.
The style, though. The capitalism, God in our rap, but it isn't. With the paper printed, when we come to decision, and give it all our thirst and all our rights, wage all that work with all our life. Now you're searching for the gift, cause we're not got some button down and sit up, shit to a lot. Carry up days on a rock called boom, decaying cage. All around. Now you're searching for the gift, cause we're not got some button down and sit up, shit to a lot. Carry up days on a rock called boom, decaying cage. All around. Choices. Slowly erode the wind behind voices. Like river will gorge, rivet and forge. Will to separate forever, whether of us wanted a book stack or at all to ask an action pack. Black violet shot kills the color where you sleep. Undoes the ice about your heat. Let's ugly leak and eat the floor beneath your feet. I'll be it wood and stone. Shooting on where you wanna eat, where you got. That's just hard. It's a roller coaster.
Men like ants down life desk, light shadows stay, stuck a flicker late to haunt office space, alone clocks growl and piss, pens hunt and hiss to scrawl out eyes on photograph kids at night, I might be making some of that up. That's just how the other half gives.
When I hear that voice, I think
it's crazy.
I think old black butler. Old black butler when I hear that.
You know what I'm tripping on? The instrumental is so fucking good.
Oh, yeah,
good.
The beat's so hard, bro. I know, perfect.
Listen to that.
In the background, hard. Yeah. I've always loved
that deep Alias beat, bro.
Bro. I've been tripping on that beat. Like,
that's hard. Damn. Shout out to Doseone.
Very hard, very hard.
Shout out to Alias.
Super hard.
And let's just say this on a real level. Some motherfuckers that were doing it without like the big buck production, a lot of money put into it, and still making quality fucking music.
That's the guys that are
very fucking.
Keep it up. I think a picture.
And like he said, is like he, when he came out and met some of these dudes and he was introduced to like real musicians.
Yeah.
Like not just rappers, but real fucking musicians.
Yeah, that's what people always say.
And he became a musician. Too. You know what I mean?
Yeah. And also, you can see, like, he was wearing his Freestyle Fellowship sweatshirt earlier.
Oh, what'd I tell you? I've always told everyone that, like, everyone's favorite, your favorite rapper, Yeah. Probably favorite is a Freestyle Fellowship crazy, member. Right? And it's probably so Mike and I, and it's probably Peace.
Yeah.
It's probably Self Jupiter. Mm-hmm. You know, it's a, you know, AC Alone is one of my favorites, yeah, personally.
Yeah.
Fuck, dude.
And when he's like rapping all the different style of beat
Freestyle
as it's going, you could tell there's some elements from like Freestyle Fellowship,
he blew,
Mike and
I. He and I even mentioned that. It in the interview, but he blew my fucking mind with the with the way that he broke down how Self Jupiter is. You always can be unpredictable yeah, with like wordplay. I've seen that before, but to be unpredictable with the rhythm and like where I'm going with my rhythm is like, oh yeah, that is exactly what that fucker is doing. Yeah. And then it's like, wait a second, that's exactly what you're doing too. I was thinking in my head to about Dose, like you do the same thing. I started like thinking about his, I'm like, oh yeah, that's what he does. I'm like, oh, he fucking sponge, you know what I mean? That's what it is, dude. That's, and it's so good.
It's amazing,
so fucking good. That's hip hop. That's my favorite thing about underground and him talking about community.
It's all intertwined, bro.
We've talked about it all on here a lot of times, is like the community and not it not being like super competitive.
Super closeted. Not letting
like
anybody else
everybody
absorb
come
your
in,
bubble. Yeah.
Like there's some other levels of the rap game or genre or whatever that are different, that are very closed off and like safeguarded, and there's gatekeepers and shit. You
hard
know
to get
mean?
In with people. Some people
underground hip hop is very all inclusive and very like, if you're the only thing that is the benchmark or your card to get in is just be fucking real and be dope
and be different.
Yeah. For sure.
Be real, be dope, and be different.
Yeah. Yeah.
Don't be stealing someone else's shit, and don't be sounding like somebody else.
Don't be a biter.
Sound like yourself. Yeah. Sound like yourself and just, you know, be dope and be
real,
yourself.
RUD,
yourself.
Real dope and different.
Stop biting.
Yeah.
Go ahead and give me the Scarecrow Speaks.
Oh, fuck.
That was dope. RDB.
RDD. RDB.
RDD. Real dope and different.
Yeah, RDD.
That's our fucking new shit right there.
Real dope and different. RDD.
Hey, trademark, blah, blah, blah. Those are our new shirts. RDD.
RDD, real dope and different.
Real dope and different.
I like that. Yeah, give me the Scarecrow
Speaks. The Scarecrow Speaks. Classic track off Deep Puddle Dynamics.
Perfect.
A Taste of Rain. Why Neil Quaid used to bump this shit all the time in the Kia. Excuse me, and the Oldsmobile as well.
That's when we just steal his CDs from him.
That's what you were doing,
Alec.
I was borrowing
and not returning. not returning.
We were tape trading. We were tape trading.
Yeah. You were just trading.
No, you're just taping.
Yeah, taping. You're just taping.
I'm personally, I'm just going to say this right here, I can't wait for the day that Soul and Doseone can mend the fences.
Yeah, for sure.
They're better together, you know what I mean?
Yeah, like,
not that they need each other, but
treat your girl like you treat your TV.
We love them both.
Try staying home, stop trying to prove, stop trying to be, stop trying to do, just be, prove, do, and exist. Go to college, respect your mother, look out for your little sister, respect no one except yourself.
I remember thinking, like, why doesn't this motherfucker rhyme?
Yeah, I know.
What the fuck?
For sure.
But God, how's it so sick? How's it so dope? And he ain't even rhyming.
He knows what he's doing.
So much better than us.
Yeah, it's like a sneak. He's sneaking. You don't know how, but he's sneaking. Yeah,
and then when you do hear him rhyme all the time, you're like,
fuck, yeah, that fool can do whatever he wants. Yeah.
It's crazy, though. He's just sneaking the whole time right by you. You're like, whoa. Actually, he's really
which
not
makes
rhyming.
It unpredictable.
Yeah,
remember
like,
we're talking about that unpredictability.
Really
come to you with one heart broken in two, gashed hands and many flaws. A man. In return, I ask only an eagle is unbiased listen for what I speak of offers freedom from mind, freedom from unfocused impulse, freedom and not at all the
smile. Just make sure that you can say whatever you want, not an afterthought. As long as it's deep.
Sense of liberty, which our forefathers in Hollywood have fed and sold us for.
Just keep moving forward.
Yeah. Just keep moving. Yeah, exactly. Don't get stuck.
Faded state of human. Grand Inquisitor myself.
We should try that. I know, but you know, we try to rhyme it. I think we just go.
I think it'd be hard. Like heart, like different.
This reason for being here.
Cars drive down roads.
These ones are also cooler than shit.
Yeah, for sure. The voice,
maybe not Soul, but Doseone is a cool motherfucker.
Oh,
you see the hair and the beard, and you're like, okay, this feels cooler than shit. Like
we'll find out soon. We'll get Soul too. We'll find out.
stupid no, I'm saying like, body.
So wears a fanny pack and trips when he gets on stage.
So does Joe Rogan.
Every somehow
has a Joe's a cool
so does The Rock.
Yeah.
So does Triple H.
Weave those silver threads into soul level is he really? Bonds and be unbounded no longer manipulative.
I guess he does.
Oh, yeah, I never thought of it.
And the blue jeans? Those one, he also does the squawk of the eagle.
Squawk! Squawk! Squawk!
Masters, my pupils, my equals. Drop, decorate. I implore you. Just think.
Just think.
Super hard because you don't even think he's really doing it. You think it's like a real bird they throw in there. And
you think it's really him?
For a second, I think it's him.
I'm
it going to
say
be.
It's Dose.
I would say it's him doing the squawk.
I think so too. I think so too. If anyone can pull it off, Dose.
Yeah, yeah.
I wonder if the fool's like, hey, give me some backups. Yeah, I'll give you backgrounds. And then I was like,
no, but like, he's talking about it's linear because he's talking about like a scarecrow or an eagle and shit.
But it's just funny that.
It is good. It's good. It's good. Always,
it's perfect. Perfect. Perfect.
It's good.
It's very, very good. It's very good.
Most definitely good.
I'm flabbergasted by how good it was. Very good. Very good. Very good.
Had you tripping?
Had me tripping. I had to think about it twice. I go, is it really him? And then I'm like,
of course it
sounds like perfect. Perfect. Perfect.
We're back.
As we're winding down here.
Oh, you knew that's your famous line. As we're winding down here.
As we're coming to a close.
As we're going
to
do a close. Yes.
I do want to say R.I.P. Gangsta Boo.
Oh, yep.
Because
yep.
She passed away on New Year's.
An OD.
New Year.
OD is what sucks. I mean,
Hold on. Is that confirmed?
That's confirmed.
Are you sure?
Check it out.
Okay.
I wouldn't want to overdose. I mean, I would feel
and
like.
We don't need to.
No, no, I'm saying know, a rough
get
way
stuck
to.
Stuck on how she
I know,
died.
But a rough way to go would be to OD. I mean, I feel like no one can help you at that time. You have to really be in the right place, the right state. Someone, you got to die for a second to get
it's
saved.
Drug related. We don't know if it was.
But wrong or right, though, you know, when you OD, it's not like you're around a bunch of good people that are going to save your life. They're getting high like you are.
Yeah.
You just took a little too much.
You know, scary too, though, this fentanyl that's out there, and you hear all these stories, and like El Chapo's son just got busted. Apparently, he was one of the biggest fentanyl dealers or whatever.
Yeah, yeah.
And it's just. There's the stories how just such a little amount are just killing people.
Man. Less they show a penny and they show like what it's marked next to.
Yeah,
and
it's so small of an amount. It's like a little pinch.
It's tiny. Did you see that El Chapo's wife was taking pictures with that black guy?
No.
Here it is. Just check it out.
What's that? All, what's
she,
that?
She. This man's the next man to make not cocaine cowboys, but cocaine homeboys. He's dating his wife in jail.
Wait, that's El Chapo's son's wife or El Chapo?
Read the first slide.
Okay. But the friends. They're only friends.
They're only friends. I mean, you're dead man.
She dating that man with the baggy jeans?
She's your dead man.
Baggy jean shorts?
Yep. He's wearing the shants.
Are you sure she's really dating the man?
That's what they say. You see the pictures together? Who takes pictures like that with their friend?
Okay.
That guy's putting his wiener in you, and she probably has the power to do it. Let him get their minute.
Interesting. Well, El Chapo is
dead. He's
going to
chop off his dick.
Out of the choppy, choppy pee-pee.
But that man is going to be the next.
Choppy, choppy, pee-pee.
Cocaine homeboys. Not cowboys, but homeboys.
Are you whistling at a girl or what's going on?
He's whistling at Von Wigfried.
have you guys got a chance to watch the movie on Netflix called White Noise?
What's it about? I watched some, stopped it. It's on my list, but I do want to finish it.
Please
get into
that.
My friend recommended it.
Get into that and
my
we
lady
can talk
did.
About
I don't think
that.
My lady liked it, but I'm
going
to watch
She's
it.
She's off on it. It's so wild. So there's so much going on.
What's it about?
There's
I can tell
no,
it's good. It's
there's
different.
No dialogue different. At first, and it's just like so much going on, background noise and like five different conversations and like six different storylines, and you're just thrown at so much, and you're like, but if you hang in there. I mean, I'm a bad judge. I like bad movies.
Yeah,
but
you're a
for
bad
sure.
movie fan.
No, but it has
sure.
good reviews,
but
though, too.
I got out. I got through reviews. It, and I was like, what the fuck did I just watch? That was crazy.
What's
but
the name of the
I
movie?
White Noise.
Again, White Noise. Is it on you said Netflix. I'm going to look at it real quick. I'm going to see if I ran by it. Maybe I ran by it.
I think
maybe
you've ran by it. But I'll tell you right now, I've finished it.
Adam Driver.
I enjoyed it. Adam Driver looks like he's 60.
Have you watched The Midnight Club?
On Andre 3000, isn't it?
You should
Andre 3000 is a professor at college.
You should watch Midnight Club.
Midnight Club is good.
It's good. What do you think of it? They got the good stories. It ends kind of weak, but the stories in between are really good. Did you watch the one where the girl with the one leg tells her story how she has a twin, and the twin wanted to do drugs, and she's like made a deal with the devil to say that she's always wanted to do whatever she wanted, but her parents are too tough on her?
No.
That's the best one.
Damn.
If you only then you only watch a couple episodes.
The one-legged
witch. You know the one-legged girl in the wheelchair?
Witch. Yeah.
She really has one leg in real life.
Okay.
So it's real.
Okay.
So in this movie, she says that the way she lost her leg was because she was a ballet dancer. And
it's the true story.
I don't know if it's a true story, but for her story.
For the show.
For her story, she said that she'd always wanted to be not so regarded on by her parents. Like, her parents put so much on her. She was like a ballet dancer, did ever great in school, didn't do anything that her parents wanted, talked to a certain nerdy dude because her parents wanted her to. But really, she wanted
to.
Really, she wanted to do drugs and live wild and be a punk rock person, you know? So the devil came to her and said, "We can give you a twin, and your twin can go do everything that you want to do. But you're going to feel
everything. You must drink the blood of Christ."
Yeah, I'll drink it right now. You're going to feel everything.
He did bleed in this.
So they fucking. She goes to clubs and shit. She stays home, and the twin does ecstasy, and she feels all everything. But she still has to go to, like, her normal stuff.
What's your take on White Noise? Are you going to watch it or not?
So I'm going to give it a check. But I think you need to watch the episode. Great fucking episode. So
he says you watch Midnight Club. He says you watch White Noise.
I'm in.
Let's see if you guys come back next episode with both watched.
Let's do it.
Oh, okay. I don't know if I've seen this, but it looks really good.
Now, the audience.
In the dark comic film. Is it comedy?
The audience doesn't really like it, but the critics do.
It's a what the fuck's going on movie.
It's a comedy drama.
So it's not a comedy?
It's a dramedy.
When people say a comedy, like, do they mean like it's funny?
A dark comedy. Or a dramedy.
Dramedy. Okay.
It's a dramedy.
Okay. It's in the comedy section. It says, in a darkly comic film, the professor, the wife, and their kids grapple with love, death, and an airborne toxic event. Did you see the Queen Latifah and Ludacris movie?
Yeah.
You watched it?
It was pretty good.
I was disappointed the whole time.
Why?
No, it was good, but she always made me mad the whole time. She wants to do this stupid stuff. She wants to leave the money behind. She wants to turn themselves in. She wants to answer phone calls. I'm like, Jesus Christ.
It turned out pretty good. Did you see the Ludacris Queen Latifah movie?
Nope. Good. Very good.
A hip-hop combo right there.
Nope.
I haven't seen Luda!
Jesus Christ.
Luda's dropping bows on fools. He's dropping bows in the movie.
Did you know that Rifleman is the father of Suspect, the dude that beat a Lil Kelpie? I didn't know that.
Rifleman? Show me Rifleman.
Are you telling me L.A. Cool is the fucking father of Suspect?
Yes, because L.A. Cool was recently on No Jumper and he talked about it.
So Lil Kelpie is who now in this?
Well, Lil Kelpie is the guy that got... Lil Kelpie's a fake pip. That has I know, girls I know, but on
who
OnlyFans.
Is he? Who is he in this?
Suspect is the son of Rifleman.
That's the guy that beat him up, that stood up and beat him up.
I get it. So Lil Kelpie's not related to these guys.
No, he's just the one that got his ass beat.
Okay.
L.A. Cool is an original Good Life member.
Yep. Project Blow.
Project Blow.
Well, yeah, he stood up and socked that full up. I give him props. There.
I just went down and went down, but that's just random. That Rifleman, L.A. Cool, is the father of Suspect.
That's dope.
I was like, okay, that's an interesting little connection. All
right. Yeah, that's interesting. That's good, though, right?
Yeah. You know what's crazy? John Cena's beat is produced by Jake One of Rhymesayers.
I seen
Did
that.
Did you know that?
No, I didn't know that.
Huh.
You knew that? Did you know that?
No.
I found that out recently, man.
I didn't know that.
Yes. We should have freestyled to it.
Because we were talking about
it. Yeah, let's see. Let's see.
Freestyle?
I don't know if we can freestyle. We can give it a try, though, for sure.
We were talking about how John Cena's, you know, kind of hip hop. Did you know the Eli?
John Cena was on an Eli beat.
No, John Cena paid Eli for a beat and because he was making an album.
Yeah.
And he basically told Eli, name your price. And Eli, I think, just threw out like 10 G's, but he would have given more, you know. Yeah. But he's like, fuck, I should ask for more.
The song was called...
He made an album. He has a track with MERS and shit. You know, like, he is somewhat...
Pretty hard.
I'm not saying he's the best rapper or anything, but...
But he does give it a good try.
Yeah, he's a little hip-hop head.
Dude. Hard.
TV got hard.
Yeah.
All right. Yeah. Here we go.
I see you front row at the show.
I got motherfucking signs up telling me to come down and wrap the lines up. Bouncing off the ropes and going ahead and give you a choke slam. The shit is going down, might as well get you a baked ham. Cause I'm great, I'm straight prestigious. What I need to do now is smoke some weed. It's just another top rope type of slammer. Superstar stunner, people getting hammered.
And I'll give you the jammer.
Y'all motherfuckers are so enamored. By the way, I grab the mic and lay it down. I don't give a fuck, cause you know I got that feather sound. Yeah, off of the top of the rope like Steamboat. Fuck it, y'all motherfuckers are just a joke. I drop an elbow like Mach, and half of these motherfuckers are always walking around lost. Yeah. I'm like Tatanka in 93. John Cena, you ain't got shit for me. I wish the new generation and attitude would gang up on whatever the fuck this dude do.
Off the rinks, I mean off the ropes, onto the turnbuckle, motherfucker, five knuckle shuffle, oh. And then I rubble. Three pin, 1, 2, 3, bitch, your mom, elbow drop. I'm never gonna stop. I got the spinner belt and I'm fucking hip hop. This is how I do it. Mr. McMahon on my side. Vinnie Mac, I'm chilling in his ride. Yeah.
Throwing chairs at Waffle House.
That's dope.
What's she barking at? She's at her bucket here.
She's a mean dog.
She thought it was who let the dogs out.
She thought it was her
time. She thought it was her time to shine.
She was rapping, bro. You need to give her a mic.
But yeah, Jake Wump produced that beat.
That's weird.
Yeah, very weird. It's very weird.
That's cool. That's a cool beat. So I like it. It's definitely like something that you're like, this is crazy, man.
A little snippet for you.
A little snippet.
Hey, did you hear that Russia? This is real talk.
Mother Russia?
Mother Russia has a technology that we don't use in the public, and they were using it, and they shot down a cloaked UFO. A real talk stuff.
A cloaked UFO?
A cloaked, like an invisible one, like in the clouds, like that movie we've seen. Uh-huh. They said it was sitting for how long, a cloud, and it's cloaked, so you don't see it, so they shot a missile at it, and they hit it. Boom! And now they're saying that they might have started the intergalactical war.
Really?
Look it up. I'm not bullshitting. Russia shoots down cloak UFO. You type in cloaked UFO. Pull up the pictures.
There is no intergalactical war going on.
It's going to happen.
When?
Well, maybe it's fucking. Maybe Russia. Maybe the storms. Maybe all this shit could be something from it.
Antarctica?
Maybe all the storms are because they're coming closer. The magnets are hitting the Earth.
Bro,
Earth's getting weird.
Listen, let me tell you.
It could be simple shit like that.
One place you want to stay away from in an intergalactical war situation or a war with people from not of this planet, stay away from the ocean. We need to go inland because those motherfuckers are going to be coming out of the ocean.
Oh, yeah. Just
they're
like, what do you call
there.
It?
They're
like,
in
War of the Worlds, they're already here. They got their ship
but
planted.
They're not underground.
They're in
the
water.
Water.
They come out of water, too. They come out of water, too. Did you see it?
Russia claimed that their air defense destroyed a UFO in the Rostov Oblast
yep.
on the Ukrainian border.
Yep.
While the Russian lawmakers claimed that it was
video.
A Ukrainian drone that was shot. So Russian lawmakers are saying it's just a drone. The air defense, or Russia's claiming that their air defense destroyed a UFO.
It was a cloaked UFO. Yeah, let's see it. Show the vid.
Well, there's just a UFO video. I mean, a fucking YouTube video.
I know, where they shoot it up and it's in the sky and it hits the cloud. Uh-huh. And it blows up.
It's a long video.
You can fast forward
this
it.
This is over 9 hours. I don't even know.
No. The one I've seen is
I want
quick.
9 hours of content.
It's
now.
Quick. I got it right here.
Over 9 hours of.
There it is. Here, I got the.
UFO.
I got the quick. I got the.
How about
quick
we
version.
Save this for 16?
There it is.
Okay.
Go shoot it in the sky. Blows the thing up right there. Huh. Boom. It's over.
Almost over.
Now they're saying that motherfucker could start. You know,
you just show me a firework.
I know that's what they say. That's Russia. That might have been a Russian firework. That's what they got. That's what they got.
And it exploded in the sky, and you're like, yep, there it is.
There it is. Got him. They got him. That's just what they say. I don't know. I don't know if it's true, but if it is, it's pretty wicked.
Well, on that note, this has been a wicked episode. No other way to put that. On a Friday the 13th, it's been a pretty fucking good Friday.
If you
have sat down and watched this podcast with us, thank you so much for joining us. Once again, thank you to hip-hop artist legend Doseone, founder of Anticon. Doseone, thank you so much for coming on and talking with us and sharing some of those stories with us. That was an experience that I will remember for a lifetime, and very blessed to have you. Thank you to my boy Yamas Nonsense,
yes,
Infamous, doing your thing, coming out and being who you are. I really appreciate you. I love you. Couldn't do it without you.
Shout outs, brother, to anybody that here gives us a chance to even give us a listen. Love the fuck out of everybody in this room, and I wouldn't want to do it with anybody else but you guys. So on that note, God didn't create this shit, but we did. and we're going to continue to create this shit so you can enjoy what we do. So thank you very much, and we'll see you again. Happy Friday night.
Hell yeah, happy Friday. If you're watching this, please go on all your podcast apps and go download and subscribe to the podcast, Milkcrates and Microphones. If you are listening to this, go to the YouTube page, check out some of the videos, subscribe, like, comment, do all that fun shit. Thank you to my boy Sig, my boy over here at JS3. Doing your thing. Thank you for bringing us the best of the best. Thank you for bringing the best questions and always having us derailing. No, thank you for re-railing the derail train.
Keep it on the tracks.
It's a team effort. Milk&Mics for life, baby. Hey, Milkheads, tune in next podcast. We're going to keep the fucking interviews rolling for the new year. So yep. we got someone special coming.
We got another special guest
the year
coming.
Of the guest.
Check us out on Instagram, Milkcrates and Microphones, for all the details on upcoming shows and upcoming guests and all of that fun stuff. And until next time, do not kill yourself, America, because we love you. Peace the fuck out.
Peace.
Thank you again for joining us. Thank you, Doseone. Thank you, everybody. We really appreciate you. All the love.
Shout out to Doseone, baby. Hey, fucked around and shot a triple-double.
Oh.
It's a good Friday, baby.
Say goodnight, Jay.
Say goodnight, John.
I almost did. Goodnight, John.
Got you, bitch.
Shout out. Thumbs up. Thumbs down, BK.
Thumbs up.
Thumbs up, brother. You're
raining.
Back.
It's raining.
Thumbs down. I'm keeping shout out, motherfucker. Peace. Peace.